Sonny Dykes looking for answers to DJ Giddens. No response here. Giddens to the house.
This is 365 Sports, powered by Sikkim365.com.
Missouri still trying to get set from the end zone. Cook throws wide.
Sports is presented by IdealMRI.com. High-quality MRIs for $497 or less. IdealMRI.com. Your health is important. So is your budget.
Second and 15. Mertz pumps. Over the middle. Pearsall. Touchdown, Gators!
365 Sports is also brought to you by Texas Farm Bureau Insurance, protecting Texans since 1952.
It's an old school formation for West Virginia on third and goal from the two. They give it to Donaldson, and he is in for the touchdown.
Have you subscribed to our YouTube channel? Search 365 Sports on YouTube. Brought to you by TFNB, your bank for life.
Next stage for Kansas with the ball up by three, and Jason Bean wants to throw. Deep shot, Arnold! He is gone!
Oh, my goodness.
365 Sports is turbocharged by Unite Private Networks. Find out more at uniteprivatenetworks.com.
Set. Ewers with pressure in his face escapes the pocket, tucks the run across the 25, has the first down, stays in bounds, and takes it all the way into the end zone.
Now here's David Smoak, Paul Catalina, and Craig Smoak.
All right, here we go. And news today in a college athletics, it didn't like rock the world, but Brent Zierman's pretty good about coming up with stories, but none bigger than Texas OU and the SEC in the summer of 2021. But today, earlier today, he had the story that Nebraska AD and former Nebraska football star Trev Alberts is headed as the number one target, now headed to A&M. Including in this is, oh, by the way, that there is a buyout. Now, we see buyouts when it comes to college football coaches, a buyout of about $4 million for A&M. That's like breathing, even though they have a lot of buyouts that they're paying at this particular time. Mitch Sherman from theathletic.com. This completely took a lot of people, I guess almost everybody, by surprise in Lincoln. What the heck's going on? That's kind of the response. Trev Alberts and a bunch of facilities being built, finishing up. Hired Fred Hoiberg, who's done a good job with basketball, ruled the football coach. So it's not... it's not a surprise an AD moves on, but this one here, Paul Catalina, Craig Smoak, 365 Sports, that has a buyout for an AD.
Well, the buyout for the AD and the fact that he's leaving his alma mater, which he was trying to help rebuild, particularly on the football field. And look, he's left him in good hands with Matt Rhule, but that hasn't happened yet. I mean, again, it's phase one. Maybe it'd be phase one. They might Matt Rhule might not be yet to phase one. Like, there might have been phase zero first before he got to phase one, given how long it's been since Nebraska's been relevant in football. And Trev Alberts leaving to go to A&M, and, you know, the only people who can wrestle away from, look, Nebraska's got a ton of money and a ton of alumni influence and a ton of resources to keep Trev Alberts there. Texas A&M probably has a little bit more, just slightly bigger, but even still, it's still kind of shocking to see somebody leave their alma mater who hasn't not really been there all that long yet as the AD, but on down to Texas A&M, who it's kind of like there's levels. Like, A&M seems to grab ADs, and then those guys go and get bigger jobs, or, you know, in the case of Bill Byrne, they you know, kind of send him off into retirement, But there are just so many different things where they lost Ross Bjork to Ohio State, who's one of the few schools that has more resources than A&M probably. And then now they go and get Trev Alberts. And I'm curious to see what Trev Alberts brings to College Station.
Yeah, this was a shock. I mean, not following Nebraska super close, I don't think that it even matters because if Mitch Sherman was shocked by it or people that he's talking to are shocked by it, that even those who are following it closely didn't have a clue that this was coming. So, yeah, I'm stunned by that. I mean, I don't think that there's a lot of athletic director news that's splashy necessarily, but this certainly is, much like when Ross Bjork left A&M for Ole Miss. And, you know, that caused quite the stir and conversation when he made that move. But, yeah, given all that's going on at A&M and Nebraska both right now, you thought that Trev Alberts and his affiliation with the school as a former player and the hires that you mentioned, that they would be knee-deep in the build-up process still and not a situation where he's ready to go move on and do something else already. It's like you thought that he would see through Matt Rhule's buildup of the football program and what that looks like over the next couple of years at the bare minimum. But no, A&M came calling, and I'm sure with a pretty big wallet in tow. Not that money's probably a concern for him at this stage in his career, but we know that A&M will money whip with the best of them, and they are always ready to open the pocketbooks if they feel like there's a move that can be made that will help them eventually get to where they feel like they deserve to be and have earned to be and are destined to be, which is at the top of college athletics. And some people will sneer at that, but A&M, to their credit, never stops trying. You know, like they've never just been like, you know what, yeah, you guys are right. We should just stop putting in the effort that we're putting in. They're eventually going to break through. It might take 100 years, but when it happens, they're going to be thrilled. So, yeah, they keep on investing at a high rate, and this is a huge investment that I think is, a definite, major headline. So, yeah, I'm just kind of taken aback by it and very curious to hear from Trev Alberts when the time comes. Very curious what Matt Rhule's thinking right now, knowing how big of a role that Trev Alberts played and just, you know, the whole going to Nebraska adventure to begin with. So, yeah, great hire for A&M based on everything that we know. And let's see if he can take the Aggies to the promised land that so many have attempted to and even gotten close to but haven't been able to fully do. But this is one of those that doesn't matter if you're in a certain conference, there's always somebody bigger. There's maybe like two schools that there's nobody that's above them. But for most everybody, there's always somebody bigger. And in this case, this was a bigger opportunity for Trev Alberts, clearly.
All the sites that cover A&M that he will be named as the AD. Here's from Phil Catalfamo. He's a TV anchor in the Bryan College Station area. For a statement from Alan Cannon, who's the media relations director. A&M President Mark Welsh appointed a 7-person committee to search for our new director of athletics. I have not received any notification from the president or anyone on the committee at this time. So there's still that. That was about a half hour ago. But everything points to Trev Alberts taking over.
No one who's reporting this has been wrong very much.
Not with Nebraska football news, Mitch Sherman people like that, no.
Yeah, I mean, when you're talking about Mitch Sherman, Ross Dellinger, Brett Zwerneman, like, these guys have a pretty good – if you had them at the top of the lineup, it'd be like the Dodgers right now. You know, like, you know, you got Mookie, Freddie, and Shohei Ohtani. Like, that's where you're going to get a lot of hits. You're going to be a lot on base a lot of times with those guys. So
how do you feel as a Nebraska fan?
It's disappointing because, one, he's an alum. He's a well-honored football player that was a part of the stretch that turned the corner under Osborne and almost stunned the world with a win against Florida State. He was a part of that game that Florida State won, and finally they broke through as well. He had given them some stability. Now, not everybody was excited about him when he was first hired. He was at the University of Nebraska, Omaha. The football program was dropped. Tracy Fisher, who I've known for a long, long time, who's either listened to me when I've been on the radio or whatever, Rhule not only will lose Trev Alberts, she's a huge Tracy, a boy or girl, I don't, but close to Admiral Carter, who was the president of Nebraska, who left for Ohio State. So those were two huge parts of Matt Rhule taking the job at Lincoln. I'm disappointed because he's an alum, disappointed because they seem to have at least things had calmed down. Their facilities already were great, but they're going to even be better. And so this is just another way to kind of, well, now they got to go through this. And you never know who you hire next and if they get along with people that are already there and vice versa.
There are definitely disastrous athletic director hires, much like there are head coaching hires. You know, I know Nebraska will be smart with it, but, yeah, you did kind of feel like everything was sort of lining up, and now this new venture into this new era of college football, you've got a secure spot, and that still remains. But just what do you call it, the alignment at the top is no longer there.
Yeah, and, from the top to the president to AD to coaches.
That's something that Matt Rhule, I know, greatly appreciates, mm-hmm. and that's something that all coaches appreciate is having that alignment, president, AD, football coach, what have you. So, yeah, that's suddenly turned on its head, and we're all, you know, guys who appreciate, respect, and are friendly and are friends with Matt Rhule. And so, yeah, I have to wonder what he's thinking right now. It's got to be a bit of a curveball for everybody.
All right, so there we are with that. By the way, Big 12, game two of the quarterfinal round, TCU up by 12 on OU with a minute 49 to go in the first half. Earlier today, BYU advanced into the next round, beating UCF, who had gotten that win yesterday. And there's two games tonight that still with the Big 12 tournament going on in Kansas City. And speaking of that, yesterday, Dennis Dodd, this at about 7 o'clock, Brett Yormark formally announces that Kansas City will remain the Big 12 tournament through 2031. There has been discussion about the possibility of moving it around because, just moving it around. And that's not going to happen. 2031, Kansas City, which has done an incredible job hosting the tournament. Yes, there is. Iowa State, Kansas State, they're so close. Missouri, when they were in the conference, which has now been forever ago. But Kansas City does a great job hosting that tournament. And until there's any kind of repercussions or any kind of a blowback for something, I don't see why you would move it. Although I know that there's always that temptation.
Yeah, and I still have the idea that Brett Yormark, I mean, if he's still the commissioner in 2031, who knows? Those jobs aren't like 30-year positions like Jim Delaney anymore. You know, you make a lot of money, and so you don't have to. But I still wonder if he wants to get more. There's going to be some basketball event, like a regular season basketball event he's going to figure out in New York. He wants that. I thought maybe the tournament might move there, but they've extended it. So we'll see. I do think he's going to try to do something there, though, eventually. It's not going to be the championship, though.
Yeah, I mean, he's a creative guy who's always looking for new revenues, new alleys of revenue. And so I wouldn't be surprised to see, you know, some kind of a tournament or something along those lines in New York, or maybe they just do what they did, you know, this past year and they just have clinics or things like that. But he's very clearly made an effort to try and get some inroads in other major cities like New York City. I don't know that it's ready or that the Big 12 fan base is ready to collectively go to New York and pack it out and have it the way that it is currently and has been now in Kansas City for quite a while, because as you know, much as the Iowa State fans, the Kansas fans, Kansas State fans, those all very close and drivable distances, they crow about the turnout and how without them it wouldn't be quite what it is. I mean, they have a point. You know, there is a point to that. We've seen it in Dallas. Dallas was not successful without, you know, a certain team playing at a certain time. And that still goes for, you know, some of the games going on in Kansas City. I saw, who was it? Maybe it's Chris Williams, I think, who covers Iowa State. I guess because they lost it to the Texas women, right? And he was talking about how there was hardly any Texas people there. There was hardly any Oklahoma people there. But there was a ton of Kansas and Iowa State fans. And look, those are the schools that are still going to be in the league, right? So, you know, you play to what's working, and I think Kansas City has worked for the Big 12. I know that some people will roll their eyes and they want Las Vegas or New York City or something a bit flashier, but Kansas does a really good job with the tournament. And so why, you know, break or fix something that's not broken, let it play out for a few more years, and then, yeah, revisit it. I don't have an issue with it. I know that there is a new Western, you know, portion of this conference that probably feels like it'd be nice to have it a little bit closer to home on occasion. Maybe that happens a few years down the road. Maybe that happens with a new commissioner, Paul, to your point, in a few years. Because, yeah, we all know that Brett Yormark's not going to be a lifer. For right now, and given the current landscape, battening down the hatches with Kansas City and re-upping with them makes a lot of sense. So, yeah, I think that's a smart move in the long run.
You know, it used to be, that when it was somewhere, and pretty much stayed there. The NFL draft in New York for years and years and years and years. And then they, you know, they're so popular. Hey, let's go to Chicago. And it worked. Let's go to Philadelphia. And it worked. And let's go to X, Y, and Z. And it's worked. So it's not always stay where you are because it's successful, because of the way branding, marketing, et cetera, things are going that way. So there we are with Brett Yormark sewing that up through 2031.
Yeah, the NFL could have the draft in, like, Muskogee, Oklahoma.
Do they go to San Juan, Puerto Rico, where there's no team, even though it's an American territory, and they would pack that joint out?
Yeah, guaranteed. They would. Yeah. But, like, and then, look, the Big 12, like, Kansas City is just a great spot to have it because they've got the facilities. They're basketball crazy. You know, and they really want it because they've got this great arena that could very well host an NBA team and hold one, and they've been trying to say that for years, and they're, like, at least third on the list when it comes to expansion. But they, you know, it's just worked there for so long, and so keep it simple, stupid. Don't try to go moving it. They tried to have it for a couple years in Dallas, and it went over like a turd in a punch bowl. It just did not work. I know there's a lot of people like, oh, they should have it in Dallas because of the – and this is before the, you know, obviously departures of Texas and Oklahoma, because there's so many teams that are further south. They're like, well, they did try to have it in Dallas, and those teams responded with a, eh.
You're talking about the tournament.
Yeah, the Big 12 tournament was in Dallas.
When Arkansas was a part of the Southwest Conference, they would flood Dallas, but they'd flood any city. That's a fan base when it comes to basketball that's going to go wherever their team is going to go. And they would make that crowd look pretty good when they were there in Dallas at Reunion Arena.
Look, when the women's tournament was in Dallas, it was not as good as it was in Oklahoma City or Kansas City. Both those cities did a better job. Craig and I remember went one day and had to do the show at the AAC, and we got there early, got Craig set up, and then I was like, well, it's early, and then barely any more people than were there when Craig and I were there with the janitors showed up for the game, and it was like, well, this is not the place to do it. And you look in Oklahoma City and Kansas City, we did the women's tournaments for years in Oklahoma City, they always had a pretty good turnout, and Dallas just couldn't pull it off.
Yeah, I mean, problem with Dallas, too, is there's not a great downtown to rummage through. That's the biggest problem. Yeah, we were walking empty city blocks where there's, like, maybe a restaurant to find. It's not a
lot of law firms
similar
and stuff
area
down there,
to
yeah.
What you can do with Kansas City.
All right, so here's one more story about the Big 12 and Brett Yormark. They are going to have – they're doing a very thorough – search and look through the conduct audit of the basketball officials. You know the story, coaches being ejected. Sometimes you're wondering, wait a minute, what's going on here? So they are going to dig into that and come make it where they can improve what they have, although maybe it's a lot better than we realize because everybody hates officials or wants to complain about them. Also, he was asked about the expansion of the NCAA tournament to 76 teams, and he would be in favor of that. Brett Yormark, the commissioner of the Big 12. Let's start with the officiating. Everybody really complains, even if you're winning. That's smart. Go ahead and address that. Move on. See what's going to happen. I don't know if it makes a difference or not. I just wish that sometimes the reprimands, et cetera, would be public about officials like it is with others. And there may be a good reason why it's not. And then the expansion of the tournament. I'm against it. Paul, you're against it. Craig?
I don't like it. I think it's perfectly fine the way that it is. So I guess we'll start off with the expanded tournament part first. But it's not Brett Yormark's job or other commissioner's job per se to create the most fan-friendly tournament. Clearly, all the decisions being made right now are not in favor of the fans. So why would we think that this is going to be any different? This is like every other decision that's been made. It's a money move. It's a get our teams into the tournament move very clearly. And I understand the Big 12 is very good, and they're about to have some more teams like in Arizona. You know, I don't know how that offsets at any additional gains that they get losing two, adding another four. I mean, I don't know Colorado and, you know, Utah and Arizona State. I mean, Arizona, you feel good about the other three. You don't really know what you're getting. I don't know if that exactly replaces Texas and Oklahoma's output year in and year out. But the conference is getting bigger, and there's more teams to go and grab spots and make money. So I understand it from that standpoint, but I just think the tournament's totally fine. I think the Big 12 is not in a state where they're having to live in fear of getting screwed over with the lack of teams getting in. I think they're going to be just fine in that regard. So I think it's a little bit of a greed move, honestly, is what it is. And I don't like it, but he's got to fight and make as much money as possible for his conference. So I understand it from that standpoint, but that's the only standpoint I really understand it from.
Now, one other note in basketball, And it
go ahead. Paul have anything on that?
I think it's so stupid.
Yeah,
record. I mean, it's just you have such a wonderful thing now. And I didn't like the 68 until they made the play-in games better.
And those are fine.
That worked. That was good. Like, that was something that I never knew that I always wanted, because most of the times when they were doing the 4-16 seeds as the playing games or the two, like those, but like now that they've made the playing games better, I like it. I like that you get to see 11 and 12 seeds and things like that battle it out. I'm good with that. But any more than that, then you've watered down that part of it too.
It's one thing to say the 13th team in football doesn't deserve it. It's entirely another to say like the 72nd team in basketball, we're fine if they don't get that crack at like a, you know, the two seed or whatever. That's I guess good for the student athletes and those fringe schools that would be making it that otherwise wouldn't be making it. But it also feels very much like that's the one area that the Big 12 can have some say that's actually weighted pretty well versus football, right? So I think that you're also looking at it from that standpoint of, well, we're a basketball power, so let's throw our weight around a little bit and try to get more of what we want, which is more teams, which is more money. And so, yeah, don't like it, but I understand it.
All right, so today, yesterday, Kenny Payne out as the basketball coach at Louisville. This was more than expected. That is why you have seen some of the rumors of who might be targeted by Louisville, and Louisville with a great history, but it's been a tough run, could pretty much reach out to who they want. Doesn't mean they'll get all of who they want or any of who they want, but that brings up the story that today I think Ole Miss extended a contract with Chris Beard. Here are the odds from earlier today. Scott Drew at Baylor, Nate Oates at Alabama. Beard has signed an extension, like a big one, at Ole Miss. Cronin, who seems like he's miserable every single day of his life. Tang at K-State. Forbes, Short, Shaka Smart, and goes down the list. Dusty May, whose name has come up as a possible target with Ohio State. Musselman at Arkansas and the field. Now, there's, of course, others that are listed at the very bottom that are pipe dreams, but I think even Scott Drew at the top, that's going to get some people to go yes or no on that. We asked Scott yesterday, could he ever expect to coach anywhere else but Baylor? He never said, no, I'm not going to Louisville. And so that will be something people will say. He never said no about Louisville because he knows it's out there. But he said he would not be leaving. Going to hope to win national championships, multiple championships here. But at least there's that list.
Yeah, I think the Scott Drew thing from Vegas is they're listening to the fans too much. And that probably the AD has probably let it slip through a source that he's going to try to call him. But I just don't see that. Actually, my top five is on this today. I have some of these guys' names on there. And I think the bottom of the list has a much better shot of happening than the top of the list. I don't know anything about odds and coaching searches and all that, but I think Vegas is way off on this. I think that some of the guys at the bottom have a much bigger shot. And when I say the bottom, I don't mean the others category. I mean the last, like, four or five there.
Shaka, Lamont, Dusty, Eric in the field.
Shirts, yeah. I think Dusty May's got a way better shot of going there than Scott Drew does. You know, like, again, I know that he was just in the Final Four a year ago, but, and FAU's, got it humming again. But to me, like, it's Louisville. It's in a power conference. You've got a little more guarantees there. But I don't know. Like, the whole thing, I don't think maybe people know, but, like, Scott Drew, and we do because we've been here, but he's literally been begging for a new arena for 15 years, and they finally built it for him, and he's going to leave after he plays 12 games in it? Come on!
Yeah, I think it's it's just par for the course to see names that are going to generate some conversation and whatnot during a coaching search that sometimes aren't very realistic, and sometimes maybe they're more realistic than the people that are penning those opinions. And I think with Scott Drew, obviously yesterday he didn't say no, absolutely no chance whatsoever, so that leaves the door cracked open. But based on every piece of evidence that one would consider significant, there is not a single point that you would tally in favor of Louisville. Like, not a single one. Like, in terms of all of the things at his disposal now and where the program currently sits, there's just nothing outside of simply wanting to make a move that would make sense for him to go to Louisville. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the only thing. He's making big money. He's got a brand new arena. They're putting guys in the lottery every single year now. I think they're looking at the fourth year in a row they're going to have a lottery pick.
Fourth highest ranked recruiting class
highly ranked recruiting classes. Investments from the school. So barring like a massive, here's $1 billion just for Louisville basketball type of a move. I don't know why that would be a play for him versus where he is already right now. And the other part of it is, I just lost my train of thought there. But I don't buy into it. I understand the speculation just comes with the territory, but I would be shocked if Scott Drew left Baylor for Louisville. Oh, yeah, the other part of it is, what conference is Louisville going to be in?
We don't know.
For the foreseeable future?
At least right now, ACC, right?
So, yeah, I mean, even at this point, the Big 12 is actually on, I guess, as strong of a footing as they can be given the circumstances. And the ACC is at a point where nobody really knows what the heck's going to happen. And if anything, if they were to crater, where's Louisville likely going to go? Back to the Big or to the Big 12, because there's been those dalliances in the past where it got very close to them being in the Big 12 years ago. But, yeah, I get it, but I don't think he's going anywhere.
I don't either, but you
never know.
You never know. But at least everything you said, every box you could check is checked. We on the left-hand corner, left side, if Baylor was here. Louisville, and I asked this to somebody within Baylor administration maybe a week or two ago, if this was 2016 or 17 before, and they were good, and they were building, but there was at least the possibility he might look at it and go, huh? He remember Indiana, which, of course, has also been flailing, they reached out and were very interested in Scott Drew because of his connection to that part of the country. So there we are with that. And Scott Drew, the basketball coach, now getting his team ready for the winter between Cincinnati and Kansas. They'll play later on this evening.
As much appreciation as Scott Drew has for the history of basketball, I don't think that you're getting him there just because of something that happened in the 80s or 90s.
Right, that would be the one thing that you go, okay, they have that, but that's the only thing, really.
Well, yeah, I mean, look, and it's Indiana's trying to decide if they've made the right decision now. Too. I mean, they haven't made good decisions as coaches for a long time, or stuff hasn't worked out, or things are different. And one of those things that's different that Louisville and Indiana, you know, have not been able to kind of maintain with some of the other, you know, blue bloods like Kansas or Kentucky or you know, UConn or whoever, is that, you know, there's other coaches in other parts of the country that for a while didn't really care about basketball that are good now. Like, when you've got FAU being good and San Diego State being good and all these different things happening, like, it's hard for you to just to be like, well, we were in Louisville. We won in the 2000s. Like, yeah, okay. That's a long time ago now.
By the way, someone brought this up on a text to us. What about Baylor basketball when it comes to NIL? They're fine. They are just fine. Keontae
Look
George,
at their recruiting classes.
Eve Missy, Jacoby Walter, VJ Edgecombe, and again, Duke was a part of that recruitment. Robert Wright, a highly rated guard. A lot of people wanted him as well, so they seem to be just fine. And I think that the football may have lagged behind for whatever reasons. You can say this or that. Basketball, I think, was ahead of the curve with Scott. Whoa. And Baylor and the NIL.
Well, Scott Drew knew what they were going to need to do right away because basketball's been doing NIL better than football under the and I don't mean that as Baylor has. I mean that as basketball as a sport was probably a lot better at the old school NIL under the table stuff than football was for a very long time, because you're also talking about like a limited number of dudes, you know, that you're getting. Also, like, he's got to make sure that, you know, all 12 guys have something on the roster, but really you have to worry about four or five making sure that they're good, as opposed to football, where if you only worry about four or five, then you're not going to be very good. So it's a little bit of a different thing, and he was out in front of it. His philosophy was different. Dave Aranda had a different philosophy, but he's now changing, so that's why.
Mm-hmm. I worry about Baylor and NIL when it comes to football because of just the number of investments that you have to make, covering far more players. You can't just get a couple guys and feel like you're going to be competing for a conference championship. It's got to be a bit more thorough. In basketball, the numbers being smaller, I think that's a lot more manageable for a program like Baylor. We'll see in football. Not to say it's impossible, not to say they're not working hard at it, not to say it's not going to continue to improve, but I just think for a school, like, if they had to make a choice of, like, what's the best long-term investment for us that we can handle, it would be basketball. And so I think that's manageable, much more than probably people would think. But, yeah, Louisville might have more, and you know, I mean, it would have to be significant, though, in my mind. But I don't think it's enough of an advantage that you pack up what you've been doing for 20 years and all that you've built here to go start over somewhere else.
Daniel said, hey, by the way, the NIL question that you mentioned in the text line was because of an article. I can find it. Daniel, I appreciate that. You don't have to do that. I saw a couple of things written about NIL, et cetera.
Yeah, it's a good question.
Baylor is fine in men's basketball, like really good when it comes to the NIL. All right, when we come back a little bit later on, Mitch Sherman from The Athletic on the bombshell today that Nebraska's AD Trev Alberts is headed to Texas A&M. Also, Matt Brown extra points at 4:15, a couple of basketball analysts in the 5 o'clock hour, and even Darby Brown will join us live from Kansas City in the Big 12 tournament at around 4:40. Paul's top five. This is 365 Sports. Petty Clinic, LowT.com. Dr. Kent Petty can help you become the high-performance man that you want to be, need to be, and used to be. As you get older, Father Time, you could just be part of the wrong side of the lottery when it comes to testosterone dropping as you get older. Most likely as you get into your upper 30s, lower 40s, and then maybe even later than that. Testosterone is all about a lot of things. Your energy, the way you sleep, the way you feel, focus, sex drive, all of it. It could affect some of it or all of those particular symptoms. So why not check that out if in any of those symptoms are something you're starting to battle a little bit as you get into your upper 30s and 40s. One out of every 3 to 4 men have symptomatic issues of low testosterone. And low testosterone, what he can do, contact him at PettyClinicLowT.com. Phone number and email available, top left-hand corner, is set you up to go somewhere to get your blood work. He will get the results, and if your results are too low, whatever the results might be, he will be in touch to let you know. But if your testosterone levels are low, he can put you in a program to increase it so you can become the high-performance man you want to be, need to be, and used to be at PettyClinicLowT.com.
Rev up your excitement. Celebrate the spirit of adventure during the Jeep Celebration event. Join us at Allen Samuels in Waco as we roll out incredible deals on rugged and reliable Jeep vehicles you love. Seize the moment and drive home in the new Jeep of your dreams. With special financing options and exclusive offers, there has never been a better time to explore the world of Jeep. Hurry in. The savings won't last long. Visit AllenSamuelsDCJ.com and see them firsthand only at Allen Samuels in Waco. Let your adventure begin.
Come by. Let's be friends.
Stepping into the boots of a U.S. Army officer can add confidence and leadership skills to your son or daughter's career path. See all the things they can achieve in our boots at GoArmy.com. U.S. Army Waco Recruiting Company, 254-598-8131 or 254-776-1543.
At Ideal MRI, we feel blessed to be part of the Waco community. We're a small family business here in Central Texas. At times like this, the cost of healthcare has never been more important. And unfortunately, significant illnesses and injuries still occur. And that's why Ideal MRI is open and here to serve you through this difficult time. So if you need an MRI, ask your doctor about Ideal MRI. You can schedule online in minutes at IdealMRI.com or call 833-IDEAL-MRI.
Kingo Johnson Realtors guide you seamlessly through the process of buying your dream home or selling your current one, commercial, farm and ranch, or residential. Camille Johnson Realtors can smoothly and successfully lead you through any transaction. With a team of 28 experienced agents who are excited about serving you, Camille Johnson Realtors services the entire greater Waco area. If you're in the market to buy or sell, contact Camille Johnson Realtors, 104 Midway Center in Woodway, or find them online at www.camillejohnson.com. Camille Johnson Realtors, elegant, charming. Warm. Welcome home.
Parenting is full of surprises.
You never know what to expect.
So after our son was born, I called my Texas Farm Bureau insurance agent to set up a life insurance policy in case something happened to me.
Sawyer is now 2.
And we'll soon have a sister. There's no one else I would trust with protecting my family.
Stop by and see our agents at one of our 3 McLennan County locations.
Coverage and discounts are subject to qualifications and policy terms and may vary by situation.
Baylor alumni are more than 160,000 strong. When we all join hands to support our university, we don't just move the needle, we move mountains. Working together, we create life-changing opportunities for students on the field, in the classroom, in the laboratory, and in life for generations to come. So get connected, get involved. Learn how at baylor.edu/alumni.
Let the journey to financial brilliance begin with GENCO's limited-time offers. Max your earnings with a Kasasa cash account and get paid monthly with a 4.25 APY. That's $425 annually. Then invest in a 13-month share certificate and earn 4.9 APY. That's $529. Earn cash and outshine the rest. At GENCO, we offer you the sun and the moon. Kasasa based on average daily balance of $10,000. Certificate based on $10,000 investment. See GENCOFCU.org for details. NCUA.
This is 365 Sports.
The 3 o'clock hour is sponsored by Waco Custom Marketplace. Meats, sweets, Texas treats, and a cut above the rest. 425 Lake Air Drive, Waco.
Game 2 of the quarterfinal round of the Big 12 tournament going on right now. Two more games tonight. Tomorrow, then, teams who have been able to rest. Tonight, KU will play Cincinnati. The winner will get Baylor. Darby Brown will join us at 4:40 live from Kansas City. We mentioned that Louisville is now in a coaching search, and some of the names that have popped up or some of those names that are being thrown out as a possibility of who they want. Targeting doesn't mean you're going to get it. It's a different note than, of course, football when you're rejected or 15-yard penalty. But West Virginia now. Ren Baker, who arrived right during that time when things got a little bit sloppy with Bob Huggins, also has extended Neil Brown after he had a really nice year last year. West Virginia now. Ren Baker begins a coaching search to find out who can straighten up and kind of calm down and get West Virginia, which has got a very proud basketball program, back on track.
It's a great job. It's in the best basketball conference, right? So if I'm curious to see how this is reported or looked at compared to football jobs. Like, you know, any job in the SEC opens and it, you know, a lot of people think there's going to be a mad dash by guys to try to get that job. And let's see how it is basketball in the Big 12. They love it there. Like, you're going to have a very passionate fan base. Sometimes you might feel too passionate, but they're very passionate. They're into the sport. You've got a great, great home court advantage. You have great tradition there. Consistently pretty good under the last couple years of dipped, the last years of Huggins and now, but that seem to be pretty committed to NIL. You've got a good AD there. I think it's a very attractive job, and Ren Baker shouldn't have any trouble filling out his candidate list, and I'm sure he's probably working on that anyway because I think it was kind of known by this staff that this was always going to end in a national search for a coach.
And by the way, anyone that brings up Bob Huggins, one of the top alumnus at West Virginia or from West Virginia, has said that that relationship is over. He was there for senior night with some of the players getting their senior night honors, but his name and going back to coach at West Virginia, that is not going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, that was cool to see some of the responses and some of the people who were happy to see him doing well or to see him have the opportunity to help send off some of the players that he helped recruit and coach. But, yeah, I don't think they're putting that back in the bottle, as you said there. So this has been a foregone conclusion, I think, for a while now, just based on the way that the season was going. Still had a lot of fans turning out, still a lot of support and a lot of fervor for West Virginia basketball, but I think this was just sort of a lame duck year, right? I mean, it was just sort of one of those where it's like, all right, let's see what happens. Kind of like Baylor football in 2016. Very much like that when Jim Grobe was the interim coach. Now, the difference is that we all knew Jim Grobe was there for 1 year, 1 year early. No matter how many games he won, he was not going to be the next head coach. But, yeah, the writing was on the wall here as the season went along, and they should be able to attract some mighty fine candidates. Ren Baker's a really good AD. I think it's a blessing for him that he's able to not have to go and search for a football coach, you know, simultaneously back-to-back. It worked out well the way Neil Brown was able to get the football side of things going this past season. Although I still think there's – I don't know. I don't feel like that's just a rock-solid structure. Like, they're just set up really well. I'm not buying in fully, but I know you couldn't move on from Neil Brown after the way last year wrapped up. So you didn't have to worry about that. But, yeah, the basketball thing's been building for a while, so I'd imagine he's crossed a lot of T's and had a lot of conversations, dotted a lot of I's, and knows and has a focus on what he's looking for. And, yeah, I'm very excited to see who West Virginia can go and get and bring into a league that's got a lot of great coaches and players, and hopefully just add to that mix as they have in the past.
One note about the Kenny Payne in Louisville. I'm not sure if you heard part of what he said last night. He mentioned that he blamed everyone else pretty much in his post-game press conference and took very little accountability. 12-52 at Louisville.
What if they just did more of this or that? That's would have flipped that record right on over.
Yeah, one of our viewers, Chad, sends me messages all the time, is a big Louisville fan. He sent me a message this morning that was just dancing. That's what he is. He was just so happy. And Louisville is a very passionate basketball fan base too, like West Virginia. And, you know, it has been bad there. They like to take all the joy out of it. Football season really buoyed their spirits because they knew basketball was going to be good. And I remember him sending me a message at the beginning of basketball season, like, I'm very sad that football is over. I said, oh, well, it couldn't be as bad as last year. He's like, oh, it'll be worse. And it was, you know, it was so much worse. So yeah, Kenny Payne was a, you know, they all loved him because he's an alum. And yeah, there's no proven formula, you know, like for every Jim Harbaugh at Michigan, there's a Kenny Payne at Louisville, you know, about that just, or there's a Scott Frost or someone who just doesn't work out.
Yeah, I would say just one more thing about Louisville. Prior to the new Baylor basketball arena, the fervor of the fans might have been something that could have pulled Scott Drew.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
I think
no,
the new arena has created a new environment where that's not as nearly as much of an issue as it was. So that's another box that you can check off that is not there any longer.
Yeah, I think so. I think there were times when it probably was frustrating for him. Now that's not the case. Not just because it's a smaller arena by around 3,000 fans or so, but now there's a demand. There was a demand, but it was still like the arena was just too big for the enrollment at Baylor University and the size perhaps of the fan base in Waco, which is not just all Baylor. You have Texas and A&M, a mixture throughout, where in Lubbock or in other places, you know who the fans are. That doesn't mean there's not A&M and Texas fans in Lubbock, but that is a bigger school. They had a beautiful arena, and they could fill that baby up, the fans and passionate, and also the student body, which I thought was impressive during spring break when they hosted Texas. That place was packed at the Foster Pavilion. All right, let's get Mitch, Paul, if you don't mind. Now, 51-35 TCU is on the verge of popping Oklahoma. We've seen Big 12 games, though, with 15 and 16-point deficits. It has turned around because of that three-point shot. But right now, TCU is rolling past Oklahoma, the 9 seed against the 8 seed in that middle tweener game.
So does Oklahoma start fretting and sweating their spot in the tournament here in the next few minutes if this score doesn't turn around?
Yeah, you know, I don't have the information right in front of me on their quad one record.
Yeah, I know they got the 20 wins, and that's like kind of a benchmark for
8-10. They couldn't have gone 7-11. 8-10 was at the baseline there. But
I think this is one of those games that you were eyeing as far as kind of seeding and things like that.
Is it going to be 8 or 9 for the Big 12? And this is one of those teams you were wondering, could they be a part of that to make it 9? If TCU loses, they're still in it with who they've beaten and also who they are and their record too. Now joined by Mitch Sherman, theathletic.com. Everybody today in college athletics, all of a sudden, Trev Alberts is on his way to Texas A&M. Mitch, I saw your tweet. We put it up about how people are all but flabbergasted. Did this come out of completely nowhere?
Pretty much out of nowhere, yeah, I would say. You know, Trev's been the job that he's done at Nebraska, I think, has put him in a place where it's not surprising to see his name come up. It is surprising, though, to hear him mentioned in this way. And, you know, I want to emphasize that it's not a done deal.
Right.
And we'll see. He certainly is expected to take this job, or has been expected as of early in the day. And, I honestly thought we would hear something finalized by now. That's generally the way these things work. So everyone, at least in Lincoln, just as much, I would say, in College Station, is on pins and needles, you know, waiting for the smoke to emerge that this is done. And, you know, there's certainly some who are holding out hope around the Nebraska program that he could reconsider. So we'll see. But yeah, it was undoubtedly a surprise. And I would say horrendous timing for Nebraska.
Well, I know that they're transitioning the president to, and now an AD. So what does this mean for the football program moving forward and the support they were getting from a former football player as the AD, and they didn't even know who the next candidate could be.
Right. Yeah, you're right about the president, and it's been ongoing for 7 months since Ted Carter, who was instrumental in bringing Matt Rhule to Nebraska in 2022, announced his departure for Ohio State. And Carter's now the president of Ohio State. Incidentally, he gave Trev Alberts an extension and a raise on the way out the door this last fall, and then hired Ross Bjork from Texas A&M to create the opening that Trev Alberts is now set to fill. Again, if this happens, it's not done. But from a football perspective at Nebraska, this would be troubling because of Albert's great understanding for what football needs to succeed, because of the progress that has been made in a year and a half almost with Matt Rhule in charge. And because of the fact that Matt Rhule put a lot of trust in Ted Carter and Trev Alberts when he decided to coach in 2023. As you recall, he could have sat and collected all the money that he received last year from Nebraska. He could have just collected it from the Carolina Panthers and looked for whatever job he wanted, whether it was in to enter the 24 season or whenever he felt the time was right. But he put a lot of trust in Trev Alberts and Ted Carter. They were the two people who convinced him that the stars were aligned for him to come and to turn around Nebraska football. And if Carter's gone, and if in fact Alberts is gone, that leaves Matt Rhule among those three. So that's uncomfortable for him. And I think it would be uncomfortable for Nebraska at large.
Mitch, and I ask this question respectfully about Trev Alberts. I truly don't know, and I imagine there's a lot of A&M fans who are scrambling right now to try it and find out more information as well. But what makes, in your opinion, and based on what you know about the successes and whatnot about Trev Alberts, what makes him a ideal candidate for Texas A&M?
Well, he's a great communicator. People remember him from his days on TV after his short-lived NFL career. He was at CNN and ESPN as a college football analyst. And you know, Trev can moderate and run his own press conference. And you know, that's a skill, the communication skill. I think that it has been important for him at Nebraska to get his messages across to the fan base. Now, it was a willing audience. You know, clearly he was well known around the state of Nebraska because of his playing days and you know, he was very visible in the state of Nebraska even before he took over as the AD. He was the AD at a smaller school in Omaha, a Division I school, but certainly smaller than Nebraska. And there's a lot of backstory there. He cut the football program there. Mm-hmm. Controversial at times, his stay in Omaha. But once he got to Lincoln, he was the native son, or, you know, close to the native son. Trev is actually from Iowa, but was viewed as a Nebraskan because of his time, spending so much time in the state of Nebraska as a player and as an administrator. And his personality is such that he just connects with people. You know, he did good work in bringing Matt Rhule to Nebraska. It wasn't a slam dunk. It was something where, you know, Rhule had to be convinced that this was the right place for him. So he has a lot of qualities that you look for in an athletic director, and someone who's going to have to appeal to a wide base of fans and supporters. And, you know, that's going to serve him well wherever he works.
Is there anything at all that, other than the fact A&M is a pretty large school with a bunch of money and they're in the SEC, et cetera, they have been trying and trying and trying. It's not like they're afraid to spend money, but they have failed a lot in a lot of things they have tried. Is there anything else that let that allowed Trev Alberts to walk out the door as far as administration-wise or what's going on at Lincoln?
Yeah, I don't really think it's about money, and I know that sounds like a silly thing to say when you're talking about Texas A&M because there's, you know, Texas A&M has all of it. They have lots of it, certainly more than what you'll find in Nebraska. But, athletic directors aren't paid like football coaches. And,
no.
You know, Trev Alberts was making 1.7, set to go up to 2.1 million in 2026. One of the highest paid ADs in the Big Ten, top 10 nationally. If he had gone to Nebraska and this was a money thing and he felt like he was underpaid, which he wasn't, and he needed more money, he would have got the money. I don't think A&M outbid Nebraska on this. It will be interesting, if he takes this job and discusses his reasoning, it will be interesting to hear what he has to say about it. And I think that Trev had grown frustrated at Nebraska with some of the leadership, some of the stuff that we talked about. It's not just that the president's job has been vacant for 7 months. Nebraska has had turnover at its chancellor position, which, to get into the weeds on university leadership, the chancellor presides over the campus. The university president provides over a four campus system. But these are the two leadership positions that govern and dictate policy, not just for the athletic department, but for the university system in general, and have a lot of impact on the landscape and the culture around athletics in the state. And there has been a lot of turnover. And in the case of the president's job, it's open right now. So I do think there was some frustration there. And he's working. He has been working on a stadium renovation project. We'll see what happens to that. But, it's possible there have been some snags there in some of the fundraising efforts. So hard to say. All of this is somewhat new to process. 24 hours ago, I had no idea that we would be talking about this today. So it's still a new story, but there's some theories there on what may have led him to want to look around, but nothing that's concrete at this point.
Have you had any indication at where they would look for a replacement, or is it still even too early because he hasn't confirmed he's leaving just yet?
Right, right. Well, no, and I don't think they've thought about it as a university yet because they're trying to keep him. So, but like with a coach, you can speculate about who the next person might be before the seat is empty. And there's internal possibilities. Certainly, John Cook, the four-time national champion volleyball coach, is somebody to look at. And he was mentioned as a candidate. He talked to the Nebraska leadership about this job when it was open the last time in 2021, and Alberts took it. I think you would probably want to look at athletic directors or administrators who have been close to Matt Rhule in his career. I would think that, I would say that the administration at Nebraska, if they're looking for a new athletic director and they think about who the most important people are in the department, will want to get the input of the football coach, of Matt Rhule, if they're out having a search, and perhaps he would have somebody that he would recommend. So, I don't want to speculate too much yet on who that might be because, and I'm not talking about Mac Rhodes. So I don't think that's going to happen. That's not what I'm talking about there. So just to be clear, but, yeah, those would be the places that I would start internally, and then someone who might be connected to the football coach.
Yeah, I like that you clarified that there, Mitch, because we were like, yep, that sounds about like something we might hear. But no, that's good to have that clarification. I mean, like you said, this is all unofficial right now. It certainly feels like it's heading down that way. But prior to this, I mean, just kind of what was the feel and what I think will still be the feel afterwards, no matter who they hire as AD, as far as Matt Rhule and the program and having the young star in Rayola, and just kind of what's the buzz now as spring practices start to get closer?
Amazingly, it's been a quiet last couple of months, or at least last month, because in a very unusual turn for Nebraska athletics, the basketball program has been top of mind, and it's going to play, the men and the women are going to play in the NCAA tournament next week. So, that's old hat at Baylor, but it doesn't happen very often at Nebraska that Both of those teams are on the big stage at the same time. Just the fourth time in school history, first time in 10 years that the stars have lined up like that. So it's been a little refreshing, I actually have to say, because usually it's 52 weeks a year of football, and we've had a little 3 or 4 week break probably, you know, since the signing class was complete and Matt Rhule's offensive coordinator situation was finalized. He hired Glenn Thomas as a co-offensive coordinator from the Pittsburgh Steelers to work with the quarterbacks, and he'll of course be in charge of Dylan Raiola when spring practice starts a week from Sunday. So very quickly we're going to get back into full-on football mode, and it is an exciting time, and there's a lot of energy and positive momentum after Matt Rhule's first year. Even with the 5-7 record, they feel like they made a lot of progress, and the defense was much improved, and they were able to keep Tony White, the defensive coordinator, away from some potential suitors. And, you know, I think he's a future head coach, but Nebraska's got him back for one more year. So, at least, so there's excitement there. And, you know, everyone's going to want to see Raiola. He of course is an early enrollee, the five-star QB signee, when spring practice does open later this month.
Mitch, thank you very much. All of a sudden you wake up and there's a story for you, and there's always something, but, Trev Alberts, not official. We saw the reports earlier. Mitch has made that clear on a couple of occasions, and we also had that quote from earlier, at least the statement from A&M's Alan Cannon about nothing yet has been given to him.
Well, Nebraska football.
We have some pretty good big news. Go ahead.
Yeah, Nebraska football sounds like you're on the beat of the Cowboys. You know, 52 weeks a year of doing stuff. Although, except for the first 3 days of free agency, you don't have much to do.
Yeah, by the way, thanks, Mitch. We didn't even send him off, really, but that was good stuff from Mitch, because, we do have some news that I think you're wanting to get to here.
Yeah, Garrett, would you put that up, please? We don't have a guest at the top of the hour, so we'll go a little bit longer with this. ACC and Big 12 presidents voted Wednesday to authorize their commissioners to adopt the new college football framework. Big step in college football commissioners, finalizing a deal on new revenue model, playoff format concepts, and meetings the next few days. Also, on top of that, as for the playoff format, only protections are expected to be approved, including one automatic qualifier for each of the Power Four leagues and the best G5, a formalized model expected later, but a 5+9 gaining traction as talks move away from leagues earning multiple AQs, automatic qualifiers each. And that appears as if they gave your Mark and Phillips the approval because they may have gained something here over the last 2 or 3 weeks with how this thing is going to be set up.
Well, look, I think we're going to give automatic qualifiers regardless of how you've earned this, puts you backwards in what people are mad about with the playoffs. So that socializing that we talked about with Ross the other day, it worked for Wendy's when they threw out like, hey, we're going to do surge pricing for burgers, and the world goes to FUR, and they're like, yeah, you're right, we're not going to do that. Yeah. So this is the best, I think, possible scenario in a 14-team playoff is the 5+9, because when you start talking about 3-2 and 2-2 and 1-1 and 1-1 and all these automatic qualifiers, it's no longer a playoff, it's an invitational. This is the best way we probably could have gotten this done. I think, you know, I'm gonna claim victory for the college football internet today, at least on this regard of the automatic qualifiers not being a thing.
Yeah, this is not a great piece of news for the your leagues are going to die, and we're us who just happen to be fans of certain schools are superior than you, and you don't belong in college football anymore. You know, those hacks that try to like kind of spout that kind of just sort of venom for no real reason. This preempts that for at least a little while. I mean, it does, because you're at least running this through the next few years. Now, it doesn't guarantee anything, you know, past the 2028, because there is a look-in provision that Brett Yormark was partially responsible for. That, based on what I've been able to read through the article so far, would be a part of this. So it runs through 2031, but there is that look-in provision in 2028 that Brett Yormark and perhaps others suggested. So if there is conference realignment, which this doesn't prevent that, like, to be very clear, this doesn't prevent that, but this does prevent the idea of, like, there's a Super 2 playoff starting in 2026. That can't happen based on this. Mm-hmm. So that is good news for Iowa State fan, Baylor fan, Oregon State fan, you know, whoever else that's not a part of the same couple of leagues. But there is a lot to unpack here just in terms of sort of the details, which are still not quite finalized as far as automatic qualifiers. Really, the main thing that I took away from Ross's article is there was that sense of urgency, but the money is more important to agree upon than the actual format. And so they're getting the money part.
Yeah, which he switched gears on that earlier this week. Yeah.
Yes, and so they're taking care of the money part, and it looks like the SEC and the Big Ten will, in fact, make double. But I don't want to lose my train of thought here because there is a lot to unpack from the model on that. But the listener that sent us all the questions that we haven't got to
yet.
CFB Plus. Appreciate you and your questions, and I think we'll unpack those over the coming days. But one of the questions that was proposed by CFB Plus, who go follow them if you haven't already, was how much, like, when do you reach a point where so much money, it doesn't even matter that you're making $70 million more if you were already making, like, is there a difference and you were already making $40 million more, but now you're making $70 million more? Like, does that drastically change anything? Or was the gap already so wide that you've pretty much got the advantage that you're going to have, and adding another $30 million or $20 or $10 or whatever is not going to significantly alter what it already is? Well, what do you think about that?
I think that's a fair point in that, like, okay, you can only buy so many players and so many things. Like, you only have 85 scholarships.
And you're also setting the market, too, in some ways.
You know? You're setting the market. And then you also have 33 other teams that have this the same amount of money that you do. At least, you know, alumni and power brokers and all that stuff outside of it. But the money that you get as a check from the TV companies and all that is the same. Like, Ohio State and Rutgers make the same, they get the same check every year, right? That's not different. So when you have all those other 33 teams in those two power leagues with that same kind of financial advantage, I mean, it's still probably going to work itself out that same way.
But at some point, you can buy all the players you want, but guys are going to have to play to go to the NFL. So, I mean, if you want to go take a massive check to be a third string running back at Ohio State just simply for the NIL money versus taking a little bit less or a lot less to go play and actually play.
That'll be the guy that ends up at three schools.
At Oklahoma. Yeah. But I'm just saying, though, like, is your dream to go to the NFL? Is your dream to retire when you're in college? And there's only so much money to go around. So I just thought that was a really interesting point because I know I'm one of many who obsess over the money difference and just like, how do you make up for that? But it's like, the players have to go play somewhere. I know there's talk about opening up rosters, but the goal is to play. So eventually you can get all the NIL money in the world, but you're not doing yourself any favors other than, I guess, just setting yourself up, you know, financially if you're still riding the bench in Columbus versus getting, you know, the Ollie Gordon treatment in Stillwater, and maybe that's not the best example, but that's kind of what he or she put in my head as far as planting that seed of, you know, when does the money difference become so substantial that it doesn't even matter how much more they're making after a certain point. So that's just something worth chewing on when it comes to the revenue split, which is going to be what it was initially. So
Matt Brown will come in at 4:15 and give us maybe his thoughts on the latest Barry Crawford. So 5 + 9 gives what? First round bye to top two? No.
No.
It appears that the first round bye was out there and, like, immediately, what? That's gone. How they're going to work everything else other than the five conference champions getting in as far as the highest ranked group of five, and then the four automatic qualifier champions. Those are the five, and everything else, they'll sort that out.
The 5 + 9, 14-team model that Ross is referring to in the article is explained like this, and this is what he also says is gaining traction. And I think when Ross says that, we all know that, like, that's obviously what they're scuttling, or, you know, the scuttlebutt is about and what people are talking about. So the 5 + 9 model is, it's the 5 + 7, but two more at-larges. That's what that model is. So the model would, he says, presumably grant auto burst to the five highest ranked conference champions. So those would be your automatics. And then beyond that, you would have, I guess, the two more at-large spots on top of the other previous at-large spots. So it's 5 + 7, just two more at-larges is what that ultimately would be. But I think the qualifier part of it, he says there still exists the possibility of multiple automatic qualifiers for individual leagues. So that is the part that I think got the most pushback, was the SEC and the Big Ten get like four automatically, or what was it, three or four? And then
three, yeah.
Yeah, they get three, and then the
ACC. They were going to get a first-round bye.
Yeah.
And then also on top of that, get two other teams automatically before the season even began. Yeah.
So there's been pushback on that. So 5 + 9 is Just again, 5 plus 7, but 2 more at-larges added to the mix. But with the auto qualifiers, he did say that the initially proposed auto qualifiers that got everybody in a tizzy, that has lost traction. He said that before, but he just reiterated that here. But there's still multiple qualifying models that are apparently being worked on, and there's various ways that could go still. But again, they were worried about the money before the format, and this ties up the money part, so now they can't actually focus all their efforts on the format, and I'd imagine hear a lot more about that moving forward.
We don't, at least, and Ross has a lot of information in his article, and I'll put the whole thing up in the chat room too, but we don't yet know exactly the breakdown on did the Big Ten and the SEC, because of maybe some give and take, do they get even more of the money? All that remains to be seen. But at least the Big 12 presidents and the ACC presidents have given their commissioners the permission to move forward with what's going on with the college football revenue sharing, and also how the 14 teams will be lined up.
I cannot imagine that they would have given them the permission, especially knowing how the Big 12 is going to feel about that. And I can't speak for most of the ACC, but I can tell you that there is at least 2 teams that would be, how many automatic qualifiers? My ass. Like, that's not going to happen.
Right.
So I would think that almost a clean sweep between those 2 conferences of, no, we're not going to give them this just so that we can get this and be told that we're lucky to be here. No, I'm optimistically hoping that they called the bluff here, and then the cards all got out on the table. I'm like, all right, what's your plan here, SEC and Big Ten? Are you guys going to break off? If not, if you are, let's just start talking about that now. Do you want a divorce? If we want a divorce, let's just get lawyers and start the settlement today. And then when that happens, we'll move forward. But let's not pretend like we need each other if we don't. And
yeah.
So this is relatively pretty good news when it comes to the college football playoff.
It's not like, hey, you can breathe easy for the next decade and not have to worry about your teams whatsoever if you're not in the SEC or the Big Ten. It's certainly not that. So the whole idea of a super league and a break off and whatever other phrase you want to use to talk about that, that's still something that's going to be, I would think, discussed and speculated on and all of those types of things, because this isn't long-term enough to completely debunk that. And, again, that look-in provision in 2028, that's only 4 years from now, guys.
Yeah.
That's only 4 years. Now, this runs through 2031, but if Florida State moves or Clemson moves or whatever, in 4 years, they can look in and change all of this. But 4 years is certainly a lot longer than what you thought it could be the way it was going, where it felt like, hey, in the next couple of years, this thing could break off entirely. So maybe that's still where we end up eventually, based on what happens with legal cases and the government influence on all of this, and whether or not they step in certain ways or not. But in terms of at least knowing for the next 4 years, if not 6 years, that everybody who's been a part of the party is still going to be a part of the party to some extent, and in all cases, making more money than they were before, that is good news, yeah, that you can definitely take away from today.
All right. Many of you in the chat room, Kim Coulter saying that this appears it could be less money for the Big 12.
No.
BU at...
Well, they already agreed to the money, right? Or like we thought, like that was part of it we heard.
The money is the money that they talked about previously. Yeah. That money's still more than the Big 12 was making.
Yeah, they're going to get that anyway.
Yeah, everybody's getting an increase to some extent.
3 times in some cases.
Yeah, they're not going to close the gap on the Big 10 and the SEC. Like that part of it appears that they got their way, but that's why I talk about the money gap and like how much eventually is so much that beyond a certain point, it doesn't matter if you're making $40 million more or you're making $100 million more. That I guess we'll find out over the coming years. But yeah, everybody is in line to make more money. It's just that there is going to be that gap, and how substantial that is, I guess we'll wait and see.
So there we are. A lot of people saying, Craig, you speak for the Craig speaks for the regular dude.
I feel like I'm a regular dude. I don't think I'm better than a single person walking this earth, really. So yeah, I appreciate that. That's a great compliment. Thank you,
Lorenzo Haynes. What's the revenue from 4 autos to 1? What did they give up?
Well, I think they would only give up because it was a performance-based model. So if you had 4 automatic qualifiers, you were going to get a little bit more money because you'd have more teams in the playoff. But 4 automatic qualifiers per league was never going to happen. Like that seemed to me like you floated out hoping that you're going to get 2. And then I really do think that the other commissioners were like, no, we're not going to give you any. Like, why should we give you any? If you're just going to have most of them anyway, what are you afraid of? Like, you're guarding against this fear of something that's probably only going to happen a few times. It'll be outliers. And I know that that's kind of how we worry about things, in that, you know, we're going to be the one time, like, you know, the one time that someone gets sucked into a toilet and dies is going to be us. But, like, it doesn't happen enough for you to live in fear about it.
Right.
And so because of that, just let it be and see how it works out, because I promise you, in year one of the 14-team playoff, the way the SEC is going, they might get more than four. I mean, like, they've got teams that are young and building to that point. They might get five. So why even limit yourself? Like, that's the other side of the coin, is why limit yourself? Because if you put automatics on it and you have minimums, then you have to hit those minimums. You'll never hit your maximums.
I want to hit a couple parts of this story, though, that I think are going to tie up some of the okay, questions that were being
asked.
Do that,
and then we break for Matt Brown.
So no school's revenue will decrease. As the CFP is expected to earn three times the amount it did in a four-team, the SEC Big Ten will see their distribution triple, if not quadruple, in the low $20 million per school. Big 12 and ACC set to see a double of their previous amounts. Notre Dame receive its own annual distribution that is also expected to increase significantly from its current distribution. So nearly four times more. And again, that's the money gap question of how much does that truly matter after a certain point. But that should answer. Everybody is looking at bare minimum making what you were, but looking more like Big 12, ACC making double, Notre Dame maybe adding a little bit, so on and so forth. But this was the other interesting part. According to the latest proposal, there's not expected to be a participation distribution concept. So what we're talking about with the at-larges. So that's the part that you can still have automatic qualifiers, but there's more of a, like, you have to earn your money versus you're just handed this because you were born into a league, basically.
Right.
And that's what needed to change. Like, that was the part that I think was ridiculous, and that you had to push back on if you were any of the conference commissioners who had a moment to push your points forward. Is like, look, man, y'all are the best, the biggest, most watched, most money. We get all that. But if we are going to have a table, like, at least can we ask that people earn their way and not just, hey, you happen to join this conference in 1890, and so you have a better shot at the playoff than a team who's been better than you for 30 years. And that's where it got to be not merit-based whatsoever and a bit ridiculous. And so I'm glad to see that it appears like there might have been some pushback on that concept to some extent.
From Sargon of ACOD, I hope I got that right, Big 12 and ACC got screwed. They should have held firm on the equal revenue sharing. The gap between the SEC, Big 10, and the rest will become insurmountable.
We just said there was equal revenue sharing, though. The equal revenue sharing is that, like, the gap on TV money is already insurmountable. They're not getting that.
Yeah, we're not talking about the conference TV deals.
Yeah.
We're talking about the college football playoff money. The $1.3 billion, I think, is the estimation.
Well, that's not equal either. The Big Ten and the SEC are making more.
Yeah.
And the reason being, and I understand the question, because I think a lot of people balk at that, is they do have the weight in their corner of the biggest brands, the most powerful brands, the most influence, and all of that. So you're going to have to – they were not going to be on par with the current Big 12 and see eye to eye and say, yeah, Oklahoma State and Texas Tech and TCU, they all deserve the same amount of money as Ohio State, Michigan, Oregon, Washington, et cetera, in a league. So that's just being reasonable and being realistic, that you're not on the exact same playing field when it comes to demand, money, all that stuff. So there was going to be a gap, but hopefully that helps explain the concept. And there wasn't any way the Big 12 or the ACC were going to pressure the other two into agreeing to equal revenue sharing, cut four ways. Just
but they
no
were
going
to give them, oh, yeah, you want that? Yes. You want that?
They were giving
them
something.
You want that?
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, yeah.
There has to be some give and take. Matt Brown, Extra Points, will join us next. That's a hell of a deal. And the story with Ross Dellinger, who's been all over it. We'll see what Matt has to say about it, if he's had a chance to digest that or not. Great stuff today in the chat room. We appreciate it. I'm David Smoak with Paul Catalina and the Dragon, and this is 365 Sports. IdealMRI.com. Dr. Rob Maxey and his partners decided many years ago that they would like to give the customer an opportunity to get what they need when it comes to an image of what is hurting, what is the pain, what is the problem, muscle, ligament, etc. Most of the time when you think about an MRI, it's about maybe a knee injury, but it could be your back, could be your shoulder, could be many things. And so they came up with Ideal MRI inside the Central Texas Marketplace off I-35 in Waco. When I first heard about their business, I was like, man, how can they do that? But they have. They started and they continue. $497 or less every single time you get an MRI from IdealMRI.com. The average MRI, and this might have even gone up even more, is $1,100. You can get an MRI, state-of-the-art technology machine. I've been in it 3 or 4 times. It is wonderful. Every time I've had an MRI, by the end of the day, I've had a call, an email, a text, or something where the images are already up in the portal for my doctor to see, for me to see, and also even an explanation that I've received from Ideal MRI. It's located just off 35 in the southern part of Waco, $497 or less every single time. And it is a the alpha of state-of-the-art technology MRI machines at IdealMRI.com.
With so many companies and policies out there, it gets so confusing shopping for insurance, and I never know if I'm getting the policy that's right for me. Luckily, I met the team at the Niche Group Insurance Agency. With the Niche Group, you can go to one company and get access to coverage options from many insurance carriers, and you get to speak to a real person about your specific coverage needs. With the Niche Group, I know I'm getting the right coverage at the right price. If you need insurance, talk to the experts at the Niche Group at 1-800-258-8302.
Don Humidor, your home with a 48-foot walk-in humidor with the elite cigar brands from around the world, including the number one cigar of the year, Aging Room Cuatro Nicaragua. Plus, they have the great brands like Macanudo and Artur Fuente, Rocky Patel, Aston, and so much more. CBD, great for sore muscles, aches and pains, sleep, Vita Dreams, and anxiety, mild depression, general health and wellness. Their staff, very knowledgeable on the subject. Anyone is curious about CBD, ask Carol and Ashley. Don Humidor in the Townwood Shopping Center off Valley Mills in Waco.
Baylor Scott & White Southwest Sports Medicine and Orthopedics, the team physicians for Baylor Athletics, diagnosing and treating all sports-related injuries, including concussions. These specialists also provide orthopedic services for athletes and non-athletes alike. Whether it's knee or shoulder pain, a wrist injury, orthopedic spine care, and even an arthritis and total joint clinic. Trust the doctors Baylor Athletics Trust. Baylor Scott & White Southwest Sports Medicine and Orthopedics wants to get you back in the game.
Waco Custom Marketplace is your hometown grocery store with a full-service butcher shop and bakery. Hi, this is David Smoak. The butcher shop can take your customized orders for seafood, pork, and poultry and custom cut your favorite steaks from bacon-wrapped fillets, sirloin steaks, bone-in ribeyes, boneless ribeyes, and even prime rib. Cut specifically the way you want, the thickness that you want. They're all delicious. They have Norwegian salmon, mahi-mahi, catfish fillets, sliced ham or turkey, variety of cheese, and several options of sausage links, and even regular jalapeno or cheese snack sticks, fresh chicken breast or whole chickens, sliced bacon, pork chops, and ground beef, marinated beef or chicken fajitas, and always large briskets and tri-tip available, plus fresh vegetables. So the great product, customer service, and tradition continues at Waco Custom Marketplace, a full-service butcher shop and bakery open Monday through Saturday. The Bauer family, Waco Custom Marketplace, 425 Lake Air Drive in Waco, or Waco Custom Marketplace.
This is 365 Sports, powered by Sikkim365.com. Enjoying the show? Hit the like button and subscribe.
Man, I'm glad we found Matt Brown back several months ago. In fact, a couple of years ago, maybe longer than that, extra points. He does a great job with the EA Sports information, the updates and all that, but also just college football in general. And he joins us on 365 Sports. Matt, in the last half hour or so, Ross Dellinger with the story that the Big 12 and the ACC presidents have given the commissioners the go-ahead in finishing out the upcoming college football format. Who wins here, or everybody, or give and take, or what?
It's hard for me to say that everybody wins, even though I understand that nobody's, you know, raw amount of money is decreasing. If Big Ten schools, just by virtue of being in the Big Ten or just by virtue of being in the SEC, are going to get significantly higher payouts, which is my understanding of what that deal looks like right now. I think it was, what, 58% mm-hmm. to the the Big Ten SEC, and then you got the 32, and then 10 for Notre Dame and everybody else, right? It's possible that was the best deal that could have been secured given the leverage that the Big Ten and the SEC were applying, given their dominance of the number of highly attractive brands within college athletics. But I would be concerned about the precedent that this sets. Not only has the college football playoff now created yet another massive incentive, as if there weren't enough already, for people to try to get out of their existing leagues and join one of these other two entities here, but it's not really meritocratic. And I would imagine you're going to eventually hear from some ADs and coaches over the coming years from Big 12 and ACC institutions, if those two conferences continue to exist as such, wondering why Minnesota is by birthright getting so much more resources than maybe a Texas Tech or a TCU. We'll just kind of have to see how that unfolds.
Matt, do you think, though, that there might have been a little bluff calling by the ACC and Big 12 when it came to these automatic qualifiers that were floated out there?
I think maybe it's possible. And as terrible of sports radio as I'm sure that this is, I think I would have to defer to Ross Dellinger's reporting on this and maybe follow up with a couple of the people that were more closely following this very specific story. Because I don't know enough right now, I think, to speculate as to who was bluffing and what was leaked for why. I'd love to know more, but that's the kind of thing like, boy, I wish I got like three more text messages back, you know?
Yeah, Matt, we had an interesting question the other day from a viewer talking about that money gap. And I mean, look, it $30 million more or whatever the final numbers may be, obviously that's going to get you a lot of NIL and players that otherwise other schools lower than that aren't going to be able to compete with. But how much after a certain point is that difference almost negligible? Or do you think having $60 million more as opposed to $30 million more is going to make a massive difference for a Big Ten school versus a Big 12 or an ACC school just from a competition level? Like how much is so much that it almost doesn't matter as a number any longer?
No, it's a great question, actually. And I've been arguing and still feel this way that outside of if you can't directly compensate players, if the only thing you can do with that TV money is spend it on facilities and coaches and analysts and plush travel and all these other things, you can't give the TV or the playoff money directly to athletes. I think we've almost already reached that point of diminishing returns. The Big Ten's been the financially dominant conference for over a decade now. If that was the only thing that mattered, they would win a whole lot more than they do right now. The ACC has been in a financially disadvantageous position compared to the Big Ten and the SEC for years. And they've still been able to win national championships in football and in multiple schools and basketball and baseball and lacrosse and compete in other things. Once you hit the minimum thresholds to be competitive nationally, and I would argue that the most Big 12 schools are at that number, then it's a question of how well you allocate those resources. You may not be able to fish in the exact same recruiting pools, but you can still, particularly in sports other than football, you can still be very competitive. The difference, I think, though, will be when, and I do think it's a question of when, not if, but when those schools are allowed to dedicate some of that college football playoff money, some of that television money, some of their bowl money, other direct resources, and put that into direct compensation. So then instead of saying we're going to launder this through a third party collective, through some donor fundraising or through this other thing, we're going to set aside 20% of this gigantic check and we're going to use that for payroll. Then I think that will matter quite a bit, because if there's one thing that 18-year-olds and 19-year-olds and 20-year-olds like more than fancy weights and more than charter flights and more than all you can eat steak dinners, it's cash. And that's the thing that's what the NFL does, which is why they don't have facilities as nice, because they're putting their resources into cash. And when Big Ten SEC schools can do that more directly, then I think you'll see an even bigger competitive difference between those who have big payrolls and those who do not.
Matt, do you think the collective bargaining model where their employees is better or a revenue sharing model would be better for college athletics as a whole?
I don't really see how you can do a collective bargaining agreement that does revenue sharing, but doesn't make athletes employees without explicit congressional intervention. I don't think the law allows it. I don't think that will pass the appeal from any district judges. And I don't know how you can really effectively do collective bargaining without having a union, which requires employee status on the other side. I don't think you can do that the same way, certainly not legally, with a voluntary players association. Now, if Congress comes back and says, we're going to create some kind of statutory exemption, singling out college athletes, saying that you are not employees and you cannot bargain about X and Y, but you can bargain about Z, A, B, and D, then that might actually solve some of these problems. And I wrote about this earlier this week, but there is a more clear path to that world if Republicans sweep the Senate, the House, and the White House than there is right now with shared governance between Democrats and Republicans. Not a sure thing, right? You know, politics can be very messy, but that might be one. That is one potential pathway for the NCAA to get what they'd like, which is a congressional carve out.
Matt, you mentioned that, yeah, in your latest newsletter for folks that want to check that out. The college sports hearing, I mean, that was one of your big takeaways, but you allude to there seems like they're, as much as we've heard about these and they just kind of come and go and nothing changes, like at least a hint of progress is something that we haven't quite seen or you haven't been able to take away from a lot of these, have you?
Yeah, I mean, I've said this the last couple of times we've talked, and I still believe it. I think the odds of legislation in 2024 are really slim. And I understand that there's an inkling of a potential compromise in the Senate. There's a couple of Republican lawmakers, you know, headed by Jerry Moran out of Kansas, who are taking a more policy-oriented view of college sports, and they've been working closely with a couple of the Democratic lawmakers. But the biggest challenge for them right now is just time. Generally speaking, like not to get like partisan or anything, but lawmaking kind of slows right before a major election because everyone's more focused on campaigning and protecting their seats or making sure their party's in the best position. And any kind of college athletics legislation is going to be complicated and it's going to be bipartisan. And the time for that to happen was probably 6 or 8 months ago, not in mid-March. But depending on how those elections go, I could see the next Congress maybe having a more straightforward path towards passing something. It might not be what the NCAA wants, but there may be a more straightforward path to addressing some of these issues.
There's been questions in the chat. Whatever the percentage ends up being, how they break it down, that 58, 31, 11, whatever number that is, teams that get in will also each, like in the NCAA tournament, Matt, get their own money, correct? Like $4 million. I've seen that number estimated at $4 million for every round that they play.
You know, I'm going to have to double check. And it's unfortunate because I haven't been at my desk for the past hour and a half, so I haven't had a chance to read Ross's dispatch in full yet. That sounds similar to what I had been hearing last week. But even then, like even if you get a unit for participating,
sure,
and the team that wins the Big 12 and advances in the playoff gets more money, I think that there's still a pretty compelling reason for non-playoff participants to be frustrated about the revenue distribution, because a 4-8 team in the SEC sure sounds like it's going to be in a more advantaged position than a 4-8 team in the ACC.
Yeah, just because of birthright. Because
who they made friends with in 1912.
That's a great point.
Well, I mean, look, that's the most important thing is, you know, what
people
happened.
Forget that, yeah.
What happened when cars still were made out of wood? I think that's the best gauge. Matt, the way that the round, like, was there anything out of the round table in particular, like a detail or something you heard that was new or different? Or, you know, what did you think of Nick Saban's kind of comments on all of it as well?
Yeah, I know. It's interesting. I actually think social media has been a little bit unfair to Nick Saban. You know, and far be it for me to be somebody who is predisposed to defend the multimillionaire Alabama football coach. But, you know, Saban has been pretty upfront over the last several months that he believes in revenue sharing. He believes that there should be money that is in a controlled, you know, laid out manner that is shared with college athletes. He's been very upfront with saying, I absolutely believe athletes have a right to publicity and that they should be able to keep any endorsement money that comes from them. And I get that it may be unfashionable to say, hey, you know, I have some concerns about entitlement or I have some concerns about how unregulated the system is. But I think he does have a point. And I say that not because I think Nick is upset that athletes are getting paid. I think that would be incongruent with what he said before. But in this kind of system right now, right, in the SEC or Big 12 or anywhere else, you know, you have your high school recruits and you're going to get a big check from a collective. The collective has to lie and has to say, but this is a check for your name, image, and likeness. You are signing a marketing contract for $640,000 with this collective for your marketing rights. When you and I and Nick Saban and Charlie Baker and God all know that there is no 16-year-old, 17-year-old offensive lineman whose publicity rights are worth $600,000. That's not how any of this works. You might have football talent that is worth $640,000, but you're lying. But you know, we have to lie and pretend that it's about marketing. And if you have a culture that incentivizes people getting, and not money for nothing, but I think money for the wrong reasons, and not letting them be honest about it, could I see a world where that breeds some level of entitlement that seeps into other things? Absolutely. And we could probably even think about this in our own lives when we've known colleagues who are people in our lives who got too much too soon and didn't have a structure around it. If that negatively changed their behavior, I'm sure that happens with 17 and 18 year olds, and it will probably happen when you move to a CBA. But I don't fault Saban or quite frankly any football coach from looking at that system and saying, "This isn't what I signed up for," and I don't think it's necessarily healthy. I understand that the optics are terrible. Nick Saban's a 72-year-old multimillionaire, and you know, to complain about other people getting money when you have two $10 million vacation houses looks bad. I completely understand all that. I'm not saying it's wrong, but I don't think the totality of his testimony is really off base. I think that's a pretty accurate summation of what college football recruiting looks like right now.
Matt, as always, thank you. Appreciate you. I know it's been a busy afternoon. Craig, anything else? Paul, nope. And good luck digesting everything. Yeah,
Matt, sure. Well, yeah.
The awards not going in the game. That's kind of a bummer. That's the first kind of loss for EA outside of, I guess, Arch Manning.
Yeah, and I just reported this a little while ago, too. There's going to be a couple of, like, bowl stadiums that aren't in the game, too. Right? If you're a bowl game and you're not played in an NFL stadium where EA would already have the rights, and you're not playing in a regular college football field, like, you know, the Fenway Bowl or the Pinstripe Bowl, like the Yankee Stadium's not going to be in the game. So, I mean, it's a little bit disappointing, but I don't know about you guys. I don't know anybody who, when they sit down and they fire up the disc and they're playing the game, they're like, man, I cannot wait to win the best wide receiver award trophy. I can't wait to win the Biletnikoff. I can't wait to win the Overland Trophy. I can't wait to win the Maxwell Award. Nobody says that. Right? Like, and I want to say, even in the early PlayStation 2 era, they didn't have all those licenses either. And it was just like, you won the best linebacker in the country award. I've written about this as well earlier this week, but EA is in kind of a unique position where they just have an enormous amount of leverage, not just with the athletes themselves, but with the schools and with the bowls and with broadcast partners and with anybody else that might want to be in the game. And that means EA is kind of trying to turn the screws a little bit to get people to take a home team discount, given what is, you know, the exposure you get from being a part of the game. And I'm not shocked that a small number of entities have said no. I would expect that to change over the next couple of years. And I don't think it's going to negatively impact any consumer.
Matt, thank you. Matt Brown, Extra Points, does a great job of breaking down a lot of the things, and whether it's political, government, politics, obviously just numbers. He's good at crunching them all in the options as well.
Yeah, it's always good to talk with Matt, and I think a particularly juicy segment this time around because of the dropping of that playoff news and the video game and just the hearings yesterday, or the meetings yesterday with Nick Saban involved. So, yeah, a lot of stuff here in the last 24, 48 hours that's fun to chew on and talk about. And I think he brought up a very good angle and point earlier in the conversation. You know, we got this playoff news that still got many details to be filled out, but obviously Brett Yormark and Jim Phillips felt good enough about it to apparently sign off on it. So that gives you some reassurance as an ACC fan or a Big 12 fan of, like, hey, is access-wise, like, the the playoffs not starting without us in 2 years, right? Like, that's a win that I think you can be happy about for a brief moment, because it could be in 4 years. And so it's on to the next, like, fight of what the future looks like. And so his point is valid when it comes to the money piece and, like, how much becomes negligible after a certain point in terms of there being a major difference. If we do see a future where, because of government rulings or lack thereof, and just the way some of these court cases are going, it does turn into a situation where the Big Ten, the SEC, and whoever else wants to be a part of it turns this thing into full-blown employment, and you have people on payroll and things like that. That's where, yeah, having an extra $200 million or whatever the case may be would come in handy. But I ask you then, what does the expectation become? So does, like, the third-string center automatically get $250,000? Because there's, like, that, there's also questions that spawn from that. But yeah, that's where that major money difference would most come into play, was if all of a sudden it was deemed that you have to turn student athletes into full-blown employees. Well, having millions and millions of extra dollars, even though you already had that advantage anyways, having even more millions and millions of dollars of advantage would certainly set you up far better than other schools who are suddenly scrambling trying to figure out how they're going to pay everybody. But then with that comes collateral damage, inevitably. And with that, maybe that's where you would see a split of some sort. But for right now, at least, the big question of the playoff, and it's coming up and they've got to get this done, that's being answered. And I think that's a big thing getting checked off the list for college football as a whole. So now they can move on and spend more time filling out the format, finishing that, and then figuring out a lot of these other issues and not having the playoff as, you know, one of these obstacles in their way of discussing the other more important and pending future stuff a bit more. So I think this is good news today. To what extent, again, that remains to be seen, depending on a lot of different factors. But you don't have to worry about Iowa State not having a crack at the playoff in a couple of years if they have a team good enough.
TCU, thank you, Craig. Also, Paul, thanks to Matt Brown as well, and a bunch of you in the chat room are back and forth on many things. Still a lot of unknowns that might be finalized or details coming soon. TCU up 7 over OU. With I thought it was 12 seconds to go in that game today up in Kansas City. All right, when we come back, Darby Brown is in Kansas City at the Big 12 men's basketball tournament. She's next. This is 365 Sports. Waco Custom Marketplace, full service butcher shop, full service bakery, the butcher shop with pork, poultry, also seafood and beef. Up and down the aisles, what you need, the necessities, so to speak, that you want, that you don't want to go to the grocery store, it's too big, too many people, whatever, and you need things that you can get at the grocery store, but in a little bit more manageable of an opportunity, a place, and that's what the Waco Custom Marketplace has become, kind of your hometown, your old-fashioned grocery store from back in the day, and even some that are still in existence, including them. You want a full-service bakery, fresh-baked bread and kolaches every single day. Waco Custom Marketplace, your hometown grocery store, 425 Lake Air Drive in Waco. Cars price right both day and night. How did your car in Texas? Trucks built for you, red, white, and blue. How did your car in Texas? Cars that zoom with lots of room. How did your car in Texas? Count on us, a dealer to trust. Average your car in Waco, Texas.
Established in 2007 and independently owned, Alliance Bank Central Texas is committed to helping families and businesses meet their financial goals. From their tellers to their board of directors, they know the importance of superior service and competitive products. Customers have confidence knowing that their financial needs are in good hands. It's your bank, Alliance Bank Central Texas, with two Waco locations, 4721 Bosque Boulevard and 191 Archway Drive on Highway 84, and at AllianceBankTexas.com. Member FDIC and Equal Housing Lender.
Developed by Startup Waco, a nonprofit organization, GXG is a program designed to support the entrepreneurial development of Baylor University student-athletes through NIL activations. The program helps student-athletes maximize their platforms and offers a comprehensive support system for them to create and grow new businesses that not only benefit themselves, but also uplift the local economy. Fans who wish to support student-athletes can donate to GXG via the GXG NIL Fund. Fund, BaylorBears.com/GXG. Contributions to support NIL activations through GXG can be made at BaylorBears.com/GXG. For more information, follow at GXG_GreenXGold on social media and visit the official website www.gxg.startupwaco.com. GXG, empowering student-athlete entrepreneurship and uplifting the local economy through NIL activations.
Riverbend Liquor and Wine now has two locations to serve you. The original on Lakeshore Drive and North 19th Street and the brand new spot in downtown Waco at 600 Franklin Avenue. If you're looking for the best in craft beers or local Texas bourbons, then the original is the place to be. And for the latest trends and online phenomenons, head downtown to the Franklin location. Either way, you're going to get the same great variety, customer service, and speedy experience. Check out both locations on their Facebook and Instagram pages. Riverbend Liquor and Wine, Lakeshore Drive and North 19th Street, and now, downtown on Franklin Avenue.
This is 365 Sports, powered by Sikkim365.com.
The 4 o'clock hour is sponsored by Boozer's Jewelers, the wedding ring store, specializing in custom jewelry and repair, all in-house.
Now, here's David Smoak, Paul Catalina, and Craig Smoak.
So, another team moves on. TCU beat Oklahoma. They move on to the next round. Tonight, Kansas in the nightcap against Cincinnati, followed by the game coming up, or prior to the game coming up at 6 o'clock, Kansas State. Jerome Tang, former Baylor coach, and Texas, with they're in. Kansas State trying to be a part of the NCAA tournament. Darby Brown, KWTX. Always did a great job with us during the pregame shows for football and much more. She will travel throughout the country the next few weeks, and she joins us from Kansas City with Craig and Paul, and I'm David Smoak. Darby, thanks for your time. I think you had a chance to visit with Scott Drew. They're practicing, I believe, right now. His thoughts on the team and where they are as they have another day to get ready for what they have tomorrow, Kansas City, either Cincinnati or KU.
Yeah, he's feeling really good about this group. You know, he kind of mentioned we're heading into the third season. And so he's feeling like this group is where he wants them to be this time of year. You know, with only one returning starter, they had a lot to work through throughout this season with their younger players and the transfers. But he feels like they're all where they should be. They're feeling pretty healthy. I just watched. I wasn't actually able to watch practice, but I watched video. And it looked like, you know, Langston was practicing. And so everybody was moving around and getting ready for tomorrow.
Darby, they have probably the most to gain of anybody in the tournament. And that can come with pressure, but I think getting Langston back maybe relieves a little bit of that because they've been fighting through without their, I mean, he's not their best player, but he's their maybe most reliable that they haven't had for a few weeks.
Yeah, I think he's huge for this team. We saw kind of a little bit of a dip when they first went without him. They were able to work through some of those struggles, but he's definitely a guy you want to have back this time of year because of his experience. And quite frankly, he just was shooting really, really well prior to his injury issues this year. So that alone is something you want back. So hopefully he can really be ready to go. You know, he looks pretty good in that Texas Tech game. He's probably a bright spot in that game. So that would definitely be a positive if they can keep him rolling throughout, you know, the next, well, hopefully you said few weeks, hopefully a few weeks. I guess we'll see.
Darby, you're there at the T-Mobile Center, as we can see in the background. I just saw somebody with sombrero walk by in the background randomly. Nice. But
Oklahoma fan.
Oklahoma fan, okay. We heard the news from Brett Yormark last night about they're going to have the tournament in Kansas City for the next several years and just finalizing all of that. As somebody who's been up there on more than a couple occasions now at this point, your thoughts on just Kansas City as the host site and the Big 12 tournament being there for the foreseeable future?
Yeah, I mean, I think they do a great job here. You can't argue with that. It's a great facility that they have, you know, the setup with Power and Light District right next to it, plenty of things to do, plenty of hotels close by. It's really seamless here. So I totally understand why they're keeping it here. We were able to ask Scott Drew his opinion on the extension of the deal here. And he said, you know, I get it. It's a good experience for all the fans. But he's like, let's face it. It's a home crowd for a few teams. We all know that. That is definitely true. And you could feel that with the fans that show up here. But he said, you know, would I, if it was my choice, I would pick to have it in Dallas. But it wasn't his choice. It's not Baylor's choice. And so, you know, it's here to stay. And I think if you come up here and you are able to experience this, it is a really great event. So they do a great job, whether or not you might have a different opinion on where it should be or where you'd rather it be. It is a good environment up here.
Darby, we had Scott, Coach Drew, on yesterday, and I asked about whether he could ever see him coaching anywhere else but Baylor. And today, or yesterday evening, Louisville's job came open. You've heard the scuttle, the speculation, even some that say he's their leading candidate. We can't even imagine that that would ever happen or be the case. Has anything been brought up to him about that at all in Kansas City?
You know, we haven't brought it up. There was only a few of us at the media availability today, and quite frankly, I didn't feel like wasting our time or wasting his time because what's he going to say? But, you know, I mean, I think everyone can agree. If you're going to go after someone, why not give it a shot with Scott Drew? What his reaction would be to that, I think we're all on the same page as far as, you know, I do not see a world where that happens. He just got the new building, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'll just say when the Arizona job came up, I heard his name was in the mix for that job. And so, I mean, his name's going to come up with jobs, period. That's going to happen. But, you know, I think they can throw just about everything at him. And I personally don't see a world where that happens, but you never know, I guess.
Darby, any surprises through the first couple games for you in the tournament? You know, West Virginia really pushed yesterday and blew it against Cincinnati, but everything else has kind of gone according to plan, hasn't it?
Yeah, it really has. And, you know, I think maybe tomorrow or even, you know, tonight with Kansas injury issues, like it might get a little bit more interesting. The door's a little bit more wide open for different teams now at this point. But, yeah, it's been a little bit routine, I think, and as you'd expect so far, and I just think it's really going to pick up later tonight and heading into tomorrow. I'm excited to see the games that are going to go on here.
Darby, last thing for me, and again, thank you for your time and great stuff as always. You traveling around in Kansas City right now and eventually elsewhere. Baylor at times can look like they are not unbeatable, but they just look so good. And then there's those 4 to 5 minute pockets, Houston in the first half, Texas Tech in the first half. And do you still have any kind of idea who they are, or is this just who they are? They're not going to change. It's too deep into the season.
Well, you mentioned the first half. The first half, they struggle. Starting strong, they struggle in the first half. I think that is unfortunately can be part of their identity at this point. Now we've seen that they are able to come from behind and they're able to, you know, get back in the fight, at least like within that Houston game. But I think that could be part of their identity. You know, we talked about that today. How are you fixing that? What are you doing for that? And, you know, there's only so much that Scott can Drew, I think, is a little concerned with this double bye. Are they going to come out flat here? Mm-hmm. You know, kind of how they have been. And I think it's a strong possibility, but, you know, they have realized what happens when you do that. You know, it's you get into overtime with Houston, but you're not able to finish. So I just think, you know, unfortunately, I do think that's part of their identity. Now they've proven they can overcome it, but you'd hope that they can learn to, you know, kind of shake some of that off early.
Thank you, Darby. Great stuff. Thank you. Darby Brown, KWTX in Kansas City, Big 12 men's basketball tournament as it moves into that second day. Last night, Texas beating Iowa State to win the women's title. And there are still two games left to be played tonight in KC with Kansas-Cincinnati, the nightcap. Prior to that, again, the game coming up in about an hour and 15 minutes or so, K-State and also Texas. When we come back, more in this 4 o'clock hour. Around the corner, a couple of basketball analysts will join us, and Kevin Flaherty, Evan Miyakawa will join us too. This is 365 Sports. Alan Samuels, Dodge Chrysler Jeep Ram Fiat, Loop 340 east of 84 in Waco. Alan Samuels with the Dodge Power Shot Days going on right now. Driving meets unbeatable savings when it comes to the adrenaline you can get conquering the road in the 2023 Dodge Durango RT. Now with a jaw-dropping $12,500 off. Also, the Dodge Durango is ready to take your family outings to the next level. The 2023 Dodge Charger RT, now available with a remarkable $9,000 off. You can feel the rush, the adrenaline, the power. It's called the Dodge Power Shot Days. Alan Samuels, Dodge Chrysler Jeep Ram Fiat, also with Jeep and with what they do with Ram, and they just released some new incentives and more when it comes to Ram, and they're, of course, amazing trucks. General Manager, CEO, Ted Teague, a great staff of people there to help you find the car, the vehicle you want, the service department that's fantastic, and more cars throughout their lot. Just off Loop 340 in Waco, Alan Samuels, Dodge Chrysler Jeep Ram Fiat.
Samantha Duvall, TexasBeefHouse.com with me, David Smoak. And tell you what, you guys keep rolling along. You do have yet another date, correct, for an online and live auction?
Yes, our next online and live auction will be Thursday, April 25th.
We've discussed how this has been unique and how people have reacted to it. Has that momentum continued as you've done more?
Yes, it's kind of half and half. We'll have a good amount of people there that are from the area, and then we have probably 40% that we ship out, and everybody that I've delivered locally to has talked about how much fun they had and they want to know when the next one's going to be. We've gotten great feedback from the people that we've shipped to. They're all just so excited about this event and they can't wait for the next one to happen.
Premium grade East Texas beef. Customers don't have to go out and buy their beef. TexasBeefHouse.com, from their family and their ranch to your plate. TexasBeefHouse.com.
Automatic Chef Canteen is a full-service micro-market vending and office coffee provider with state-of-the-art vending equipment, a wide variety of products, and offering custom-fitted micro-market vending office coffee solutions for your employee break room. You want a full break room solution and a workplace oasis? Well, Automatic Chef Canteen, locally owned and operated for over 50 years in Central Texas, also includes in-house mechanics on call 24/7 for fast, reliable service and maintenance. Automatic Chef Canteen, 6900 Imperial Drive in Waco, or online at automaticchefcanteen.com.
Our good friend Brad Boozer, Boozer's Jewelers, here at 365 Sports. Now, Brad, people who watch and listen to our show know I'm a double-time customer for you, engagement ring and wedding band, and you guys do that great, but that's not all you do at Boozer's Jewelers.
Absolutely. And I always like to say, you know, it's a new year. It's a great way to start the year out. Go through your old jewelry. Go through your wife's jewelry box. Go through anything you're maybe not wearing, something that's broken, something that you're not using. We do a massive amount of custom work. We can take your old jewelry, old diamonds, old watches, and we can convert it into something special for you and make a one-of-a-kind piece of jewelry. And if that's not something you're interested in, a great thing is we can turn that into cash. So we buy gold, we buy diamonds, we'll buy Rolex watches, any kind of heirloom jewelry, anything that's maybe passed down to you.
Boozer's Jewelers, where do they find you, Brad?
We're at 1025 North Valley Mills Drive, right on the corner of Lake Air Drive and Valley Mills with the big clock on the corner.
This is 365 Sports. Text us at 254-339-1122. The text line is sponsored by Riverbend's Liquor and Wine, with the most extensive variety of craft beer in Waco, a hidden gem on Lakeshore Drive and 19th Street.
365 Sports here, wrapping up this 4 o'clock hour. NFL free agency continues. Paul and Craig, a couple of updates. I saw the Calvin Ridley news, but we'll get to that and more.
Well, Calvin Ridley with a contract with the Titans, which is at $92 million, I think $50 million of it guaranteed, steps into a wide receiver room with DeAndre Hopkins and a first-round draft pick from a couple years ago who hasn't been fully healthy in Treylon Burks. So they're trying to do right by Will Levis and build the offense up around him. And if it's not Will Levis, then they're going to have a nice little landing spot for whoever the next quarterback is in Tennessee when you've got that kind of offense around him. And they brought in Tony Pollard as well. But Bobby Wagner to the Commanders. The Commanders keep building up with some Dan Quinn favorites. And he coached Bobby Wagner in Seattle. He coached Dorrance Armstrong. He coached Dante Fowler at a couple different places. So interesting offseason so far for the Commanders. And as of right now at 4:52 p.m. Central Time, the Cowboys have not turned on their cell phones.
Yeah, I mean, I can understand the building frustration as they've really done practically nothing at this point in comparison. I mean, but at the same time, like, do they need to make as many moves as the Commanders need to make? No, but the Eagles and Giants, and I guess the Giants don't really belong in the Eagles category either, but, I mean, they've still been feverishly adding or positioning themselves in comparison to what seems like what the Cowboys have done, which again is amounting to really a lot of nothing at this point. So yeah, I understand the frustration that's building there, and I got something maybe we can talk about tomorrow in terms of Dallas and free agents that'll fill up a segment. So just remind me about that. But yeah, the Commanders have been awfully busy. You know, I'm not over the moon about Dan Quinn. I think that there's not really a coach that they could have gotten that I would have been over the moon for, though, because of just the way the franchise has been run for so many years. But as they make these moves, you see the vision starting to build up, and you see him going to the bag that he knows all too well when it comes to personnel and bringing in some guys who are familiar and should – if anything, I see like the reaction to Bobby Wagner is, first of all, for the uninformed, is, oh, he's old and he's washed. Well, it's a one-year deal, so if he is, yep, then it's not really that much of an investment. And number two, he had a pretty good year last year, so it's not like a guy on the very last leg of his career. And as far as building a foundation and a culture goes, would you rather not have a Bobby Wagner or yeah, some of the other guys that they have brought in at this point? So I think even with some of the older players, it's not even about like them being Commander stars for the next 5 years. It's about like setting that tone and molding that roster in the vision of what Dan Quinn wants the attitude and the culture and all those things to be. So I really like that signing for Washington of Bobby Wagner. I'm not over the moon about, you know, every single one of them, but I can see, you know, what Dan Quinn's doing, and it's exciting because they haven't had really any sort of excitement that's crossed, you know, over into my lane much at all over the last few years, outside of a draft pick or two or Terry McLaurin being pretty good. So it's fun to see them not starting from scratch, but starting a brand new thing in so many ways.
Yeah, but look, brought in Marcus Mariota to play the backup quarterback.
Yeah, and, fine.
Help the rookie along. Again, but Marcus Mariota, also a culture guy.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to get good locker room with a guy like Marcus Mariota there. And you're right, going to get those things. You're going to get good locker room with Dan Quinn there. The Falcons, people forget that, like, Dan Quinn had the Falcons on the verge of winning the Super Bowl. Yeah. So it's not like he doesn't know how to help a team win. It's just from that point on, you know, sports are weird like that. You have that one moment that, you know, you come so close to the thing, and then the GOAT takes it away from you, and you can never get it back as a group because you can't you can't get past that moment. And it doesn't mean that everybody forgot how to do it. It's just that thing is just going to live over you forever. And, you know, he's moved on and done well in Dallas, and now he gets another shot. Obviously, I'm happy for my friends in this room who are Commanders fans that they might experience joy.
Everybody in this room except both you and Jack.
Yeah, I'm never happy for Jack in any regard whatsoever because he's very sour and mean to me. But as a Cowboys fan, I hate to see an organization that's been an automatic dub, you know, 90% of the time, looking like it's finally finding its way out of that.
Well, it's about time. I mean, after years, I think Washington fans deserve it at this point with the Snyder ownership lasting as long as it did. And I'm not going to mention the running back that they signed because the last time I simply clicked on his name on Twitter, it was like mentioned, it was for me for like a year. But I think that all of the signings that they've had as a nice combination of veterans and guys who are culture builders or culture fits. And so I'm excited, especially anybody defensively that Dan Quinn brings in. I'm just going to assume that he knows what he's doing there as far as personnel goes with a Dante Fowler or Jeremy Chinn, among others. Bobby Wagner now. So, yeah, it's kind of fun. And I can't remember the last time really that free agency was much on my radar. I don't know about you guys, but the draft's kind of the thing I always looked forward to, Garrett. And it's kind of cool to just see them making moves that hopefully are building to something better than what we've seen basically since RG3 got hurt.
Yeah, I mean, that's really been the only hope there. And I'm kind of with you. I don't know what to make of Dan Quinn, but it's better than what we've had. And the moves that he's making, it's showing that he has a sense of what it takes to kind of go in there and rejuvenize the franchise. Hopefully we can get some dubs out of it.
Yep, that's going to be the big question. But, Dan Quinn so far, so good. We'll see how the rest of it goes. It's free agency. There's been plenty of teams that have won Super Bowls in free agency, and then they're absolute dog mess the actual season rolls around. But I'm at least intrigued, which is the first time I can say that in a while.
Do you guys see anything that they've done that they went over the ledge? A bad it depends on how somebody performed, but has Washington like just splurged like they have been known to do in the past, or are these all what seem to be making sense?
They're out of all of them in 3 years.
Yeah.
Like 3 years, clean, free and clear.
A bunch of them are 1 year deals.
Yeah, a bunch of them are 1 year. So at most, so far, they're out of all of them in 3 years. And this can help them build a team that can build some momentum and win. Are they going to win the Super Bowl with a rookie quarterback and Marcus Mariota and free agent signings? No. But could they actually compete in the division? Maybe.
Unless, if that quarterback they go and draft ends up being the next C.J. Stroud as impact goes, yeah.
Yeah. So, there's potential there where there hasn't been for so long. And the Dan Snyder liked to do the thing of like, oh, this guy was great in 1995, and now it's 2004, so let's go get him.
Or the Haynesworth deal.
Yeah.
By the way, the Trev Alberts now is official. Max Olson, staff members have been notified that he's leaving Nebraska to head to Texas A&M as their new AD.
I want to comment on that, but I will say the one that I initially kind of just went, was the Dorrance Armstrong, 3 years, $15 million per year. I think there was some but does anybody know him better than Dan Quinn at this point? He's been coaching him the last few years. So
I'll tell you, the Cowboys will miss him.
Yeah.
He's made big plays.
Right. So that's one where you're like, I don't know, that's a lot of money. But then again, hey, you trust the process, right? But to the Trev Alberts news, obviously that's huge for both parties involved here, Texas A&M and Nebraska. Very curious of – what Matt Rule's opinion on this is and just sort of how that changes the structure there in Lincoln, Nebraska. But that's a blow to the ego for sure.
Absolutely.
That you got your AD who's a homegrown guy who's gone and made some big moves for you that's just sort of out of the blue moving to a place that he wasn't previously affiliated with, certainly not to the extent that he was affiliated with you. So, yeah, that's an ego blow for Cornhuskers fans, but – it seems to be a good hire for Texas A&M. At the same time, there's nothing guaranteed about this, just like there wasn't with Ross Bjork or, any other hire. So we'll see if he's successful. But I think, resume-wise, he's a really good get for the Aggies, and let's see what he does with the job.
By the way, one question. David Hellman brought this up, who's a great friend of ours, who covers the NFL, Cowboys 2 for Fox Sports. Bobby Wagner's been available in March for 3 consecutive years. He links back up with Dan Quinn the first year he's not in Dallas. I find the timing interesting and amusing.
Well, that's a good point.
Again,
the Cowboys haven't needed linebackers.
Look, the Cowboys have this thing. If we didn't draft them, they suck at football. I'm not. It's frustrating.
There's this. I'll do a segment tomorrow on it. But I heard Paul not whining or anything, but frustrations over the free agency of the Cowboys. And first I was like, yeah, it's not that big of a deal. And especially when you're trying to compare it to somebody else who's maybe super active, the situations aren't exactly the same. But after hearing some stuff yesterday and kind of going year after year after year, it's a very interesting list of who they have signed and who all they have missed out on. And we'll get to that tomorrow. We can go a little bit more in depth with that. But
Should I bring it a stuffed animal something
maybe,
to hold?
Maybe. I mean, it's going to be frustrating to hear for sure, but we'll get to that tomorrow. And, I would be very frustrated if I was a Cowboys fan at this point as well. It was one thing on day one. It's another thing when they're still awfully quiet and you're seeing some of the moves others in the division are making. But, hey, they were also a team that was in the playoffs and you feel knocking on the door. So maybe people are overreacting because of the star on the helmet. But then again, based on overall results for the last 20-plus years, maybe they're not overreacting.
When we come back, we'll hear from Kevin Flaherty on the Big 12 Men's Basketball Tournament, and then also Evan Miyakawa on the national scene. He has this formula, runs like an algorithm, and spits out different, who wins and who's in the Final Four, who are a couple of surprises, does that all the time. And we'll hear from him today as well, plus Paul's Top 5. This is 365 Sports.
Richard Carr, Buick GMC Cadillac, they are the people that you can count on for your automotive needs. And right now they're celebrating big anniversary savings over at Richard Carr. This month of March, the madness is on, and so are the savings over at Richard Carr, as they have been a go-to for me when I've had issues with my vehicle, and they've been a go-to for people all over Central Texas. 25 years of business continuing on this month, and they are offering mad savings in this mad month of March, like thousands on a GMC Sierra SLT crew cab. Plus, qualified buyers can get 1.9% financing for 72 months on those Sierra SLT crew cabs. And if you're a military or first responder, you can save an additional $500 on top of all of that as well. And this being the month of March, if you purchase a car or truck during this anniversary event, you can get a 65-inch 4K TV just in time to watch all of the madness throughout this month and everything else that will follow it. So during this 25th anniversary event, big savings in general, but on over 90 highly inspected used cars and trucks, in addition to the new offerings like the Sierra SLT Crew Cab that I talked about at the beginning. And with those used cars and trucks, much like their new offerings, 100% credit approval is always their goal. They say yes when others say no. So go and find big savings now on the over 90 highly inspected used cars and trucks, or the brand new GMC Sierra SLT Crew Cab, among their many other offerings. You can get more details when you go by the dealership or visit the website or give them a phone call. But for 25 years in Central Texas and continuing forward, Richard Carr has built a reputation as the people you can count on for your automotive needs. Log on to richardcarr.com today. Call him now. Go see him now off Highway 6 at the Imperial exit.
It was broad daylight. I stepped into a gas station for 5 minutes to grab a snack, and just like that, my car was broken into. They made out like a bandit. My laptop, my phone, everything. I called my agent to see what could be done, and he restored my faith in humanity. My claim was processed so quickly, and I was able to recover my losses.
Stop by and see our agents at one of our three McLennan County locations.
Coverage and discounts are subject to qualifications and policy terms and may vary by situation.
Thank you for calling your local Marco's Pizza. We're turning up the heat with our new Reaper Cheesy Bread. Fresh, house-made dough is topped with a spicy cheese blend infused with jalapeno, habanero, and Carolina Reaper peppers. At only $5.99, this limited-time product is a hot deal. Add it to your order while you can. A Marco's team member will be with you shortly.
Marco's Pizza. Pizza lovers get it. And that offer on the Reaper Cheesy Bread is available right now at any of the five Marco's Pizza locations in Waco, including Belmead, China Spring, Robinson, Woodway, and Hewitt. Order online at marcos.com. Call for a pickup or delivery. Marco's Pizza is turning up the heat with their all-new Reaper Cheesy Bread with fresh, hot, house-made dough topped with a spicy cheese blend infused with jalapeno, habanero, and Carolina Reaper peppers at only $5.99 and for a limited time only. Marco's Pizza, the fastest-growing pizza brand in America, five locations in Waco, and the new Reaper Cheesy Bread. Marco's Pizza. Pizza lovers get it.
Established in 2007 and independently owned, Alliance Bank Central Texas is committed to helping families and businesses meet their financial goals. From their tellers to their board of directors, they know the importance of superior service and competitive products. Customers have confidence knowing that their financial needs are in good hands. It's your bank, Alliance Bank Central Texas, with two Waco locations, 4721 Bosque Boulevard and 191 Archway Drive on Highway 84, and at AllianceBankTexas.com. Member FDIC. I see an equal housing lender.
Stepping into a new pair of boots is great, but stepping into the boots of a U.S. Army officer can also add confidence and leadership skills to your son or daughter's career path. There are more than 150 occupational specialties to help them find the best fit for their future. See all the things your son or daughter can achieve in our boots at GoArmy.com. U.S. Army Waco Recruiting Company, 254-598-8131 or 254-776-1543.
This is 365 Sports.
The Sikkim 365 app is brought to you by Alan Samuels Dodge Chrysler Jeep Ram Fiat. Come by, let's be friends.
Kevin Flaherty, college basketball analyst, writer, joins us on 365 Sports. The Big 12 in a pause until Texas and K-State start up here in a little bit, and then Kansas and also Cincinnati. Kevin, thank you very much. Oklahoma's out. Kansas State, of course, on the bubble. What are your thoughts about OU in the tournament? Are they in based on their quad ones? Are they, no matter what happened today, going to be okay?
Yeah, I think they're going to be okay. You know, they were in a spot where heading into the day, they were projecting, a lot of people felt like, as a 9 seed. And so when you look at how far there is to drop, the number of teams on the bubble, the teams that would essentially have to win out pretty much to force Oklahoma out, I think that the Sooners are going to hear their name called on Selection Sunday. It might not be as a 9 seed, but I do think that they're safely in at this point.
Have you seen anything movers and shakers wise nationwide that that caught your eye? Perhaps Gonzaga and St. Mary's.
You know, it's interesting. Gonzaga is such a fascinating team this year because Gonzaga always challenges itself in the non-conference slate. And typically that has been something that people have been able to look at on Selection Sunday because they win, you know, more than they don't. And this year's Gonzaga team is quite a bit different. Obviously, not the best team in its conference. And people are all of a sudden having to make, you know, a very different decision as far as the Zags go. They're not the best team in the West Coast Conference. They're not the auto bid in the West Coast Conference. And so with St. Mary's being that program, you do look at the fact that Gonzaga was able to go to Kentucky and get a quad one win, was able to beat St. Mary's. But outside of that, the resume is pretty flat, and they didn't do as much with those opportunities that they usually have. I think Gonzaga is a team that if you ask somebody, hey, are they one of the best 64 teams in the country? Obviously. But you start looking at that resume, you start looking at other programs that potentially have a case to be in there, things start to get a little bit shakier. And so I'm very interested to see how the committee is going to treat Gonzaga's resume this year. Does Gonzaga get a little bit of the benefit of the doubt because they went ahead and played those more challenging games and did some of those things even though it didn't pay off? Or is it the sort of thing that leaves them holding the bag on Selection Sunday?
Kevin, I wanted to ask you about a couple of coaching situations in the Big 12 right now. You had Oklahoma State. Their very tough season comes to an end at the hands of UCF, and obviously no official word on Mike Boynton yet, but also West Virginia making it clear today that they're going to move on from interim Josh Eiler, which is not a surprise, and they were obviously dealt a very tough hand. But just your opinions on what is now an open West Virginia job and also the potential there at Oklahoma State, and just kind of your thoughts on them moving forward.
Yeah, I think that West Virginia job is a terrific one. Don't forget that before the suspension of Bob Huggins and eventual dismissal or resignment or however you want to put it, you know, this is a team that a lot of people thought was maybe, you know, number three or number four in the Big 12 based on that transfer class that they were able to land. And obviously, some of those guys wind up leaving and scattering, but it's a program where you're going to have enough NIL money. And that's such, you know, that's such a dirty phrase to a lot of people, but it's the way that a lot of people look at coaching jobs. Am I going to have enough to be able to invest in getting a college basketball team? And a lot of people think that, oh, you have to go out and spend $2 million or whatever it costs to go get Hunter Dickinson. That's not it at all. I heard from a Power 5 head coach this year that he said going into the portal and getting a guy who is a major conference level starter is going to cost you around $400,000. And that's not, you know, a star. That's not Dalton Connect. That's not All-American, whatever else. That's just getting somebody to fill out your starting five. And so when you look at that, and look at just the general cost of doing business, especially in the transfer portal right now, you want to go somewhere where you have that level of investment. And I think that there is that at West Virginia, or at least they've shown a recent history of being able and willing to do that. I think Oklahoma State's a really interesting job in that there was some real young talent, I thought, on this year's team. You have to think that Mike Boynton's been given enough opportunity that they're probably going to wind up moving on there. Whoever they get, you know, it's going to be interesting to see if they can keep those guys from entering the portal or keep them, you know, keep them around on campus. You know, one of the things that Kim English did this year when he took over his job that was so vital was convincing a lot of the guys to come back, even if it didn't seem like it would mean as much in year one. And so I don't know what direction they're going to go there. I know obviously Doug Gottlieb kind of campaigns for it really loudly whenever it opens up. But I do think that there are some positives about that job as well. And I would not be a bit surprised to see even more movement in the Big 12 coaching cycle, you know, over the course of this offseason.
I'm going to ask about Louisville in a second, but Mike Boynton, do you think, I mean, he's probably going to have to go to a mid-major, but I don't think his story ends at Oklahoma State. I think he goes to a mid-major and gets right, kind of like Shaka Smart, and then maybe sees his next wave.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I had a really nice sit-down with him, not this year, but last year, at Big 12 Media Days, and it was after they were coming off all the NCAA penalties and everything, and I thought it was really interesting. He brought up the Kansas case specifically, and he said, you know, if we had it all to do over again, we would have fought the NCAA on that stuff. We wouldn't have, you know, cooperated to the extent that we cooperated because we basically put our life in their hands and gave them the choice of what to do with it. And he talked about how damaging that was to them as a program, just when you don't have that something to play for and you're trying to practice and you're trying to play out a season and you're trying to get somebody to say, hey, look, I get that this game does not matter because you don't have a postseason, but I still need you to give everything that you have and continue to develop and everything. That's a huge challenge. And I think that having that the year that they did when possibly they were going to have another NCAA tournament team and possibly, you know, close on obviously that Cade Cunningham team that found some success as well. I think it was kind of a rough ending the way that all of that went. And I would not be a bit surprised to see him go down a level, but sort of find his footing. And it wouldn't surprise me to see him at a major conference level again, you know, here in a few years. But I do think it's going to take another stop somewhere else to get there.
We have discussed before. In fact, Scott was on our show yesterday. You have seen the smoke, the speculation, and even he's the number one target of Louisville. Scott Drew at Baylor. He made the comment that he hopes to be around at Baylor to win a bunch of national championships. He didn't divulge or say anything particularly about Louisville. We just don't see that. It doesn't mean we're blind but he just moved into something he's been wanting forever in the new Foster Pavilion, which has been spectacular. Can you see any reason he would go there that we don't?
You know, I think it's every coach that I've ever talked to, you know, they're drawn by the ability to sort of start something fresh. But what I'll say in addition to that is nobody started anything more fresh than what Scott Drew has already done at Baylor. The challenge that he undertook, you know, after Dave Bliss and all of the things that went down there, you know, you can argue potentially, hey, Bill Self is a better coach because he has more national titles or whatever else. I would argue that I don't know of any other coach who could have built Baylor into a national champion knowing what we knew and the shape that roster was in when he took it over and all the things that he had to do. And you look at his coaching tree and how much success that they've had, and that tells you the talent that he had for identifying people. And that's all a really long way to say that, you know, I realize that Louisville is, when you look historically, they're kind of a borderline blue blood. They're not a blue blood, but they're in that, you know, also included, you know, discussion. But at the same time, I think that when you look at where Louisville is as a program right now, yes, the level of investment is potentially high. But the other part of it is that Scott Drew has Baylor where he wants it. You know, he's getting the recruits that he wants. He's been able to build the kind of program that he wants. And not to put too fine of a point on it, but two of the most faith-driven coaches that I've ever talked to are Scott Drew and Jerome Tang. And I think that being at Baylor gives Scott Drew, I don't want to say an outlet, but an environment where that's not just accepted. It's something that, you know, it is to be admired when you look at culture of joy and all of those things. And so I think, yes, you know, Louisville, it's a really shiny package. There are a lot of appealing things about being the person who goes and turns Louisville back into a power school. I just wonder why Scott Drew would want to go do that when he already has the power school that he's at, that he's built, and quite frankly, that he's due for a spot, you know, with a statue somewhere by the time he hangs them up.
Kevin, thank you. Enjoy. Appreciate your time. Kevin Flaherty, college basketball writer, analyst, with us on 365 Sports as the Big 12 heads to the second session today up in Kansas City. I get the impression, checking on a couple of things now, that the news today from Ross Dellinger, and I reached out to Ross, but I reached out to others as well. I am not so sure, guys, if the Big 12 or the ACC got anything from today's news. We've mentioned the percentages, right? Most likely with the 58%, the Big 10 and the SEC will both split 29% each. I think the ACC will get a slight uptick over what the Big 12 gets. So there's 32. So maybe 17-15, because 16-16 would be equal. So I think you would see the ACC get a slight uptick of a couple of percentages over the Big 12. And then everybody else is left, whatever the 10% is. I'm not so sure, based on some feedback I've received now, that I'm not so sure the Big 10 or the Big 12 and the ACC got anything out of the format change either.
Well, I mean, look, if...
If that's the case, then why would you then do that? You have no choice, otherwise you bleed to death.
I mean, it's still better than the automatic qualifiers. I think that, like, it's the lesser of those two evils. So as far as getting anything out of it, you at least prevent... Because what you do allow yourself to do if you have no automatic qualifiers is, if there's a year where three Big 12 teams are in the top 14, you can get in then. If there's a year with automatic qualifiers and you have three Big 12 teams in the top 14 and there's a Big 10 team that's their third team that's out of it, then your third team goes away and their third team goes in because you have automatic qualifiers. So that is something, and that is better. But financially, obviously, they didn't gain anything and they weren't going to. But I do think that the non-automatic qualifiers, you know, outside of the, you know, each conference getting one for the champion, I think that is a win in and of itself, because otherwise you're really restricting what you can do.
Yeah, I think it's too early to declare a winner or a loser in this. You know, like, we just got the news a couple of hours ago. There's still details to be finalized, and I think we need to see and let it sizzle a little bit more before it's fully cooked and can really have an opinion on the final dish. But I think clearly there was enough there that the Big 12 and the ACC agreed to this. Like, they didn't have to do that. They could have kept fighting it. I guess the part of it is inclusion, because there's always that fear that somehow you're going to get left out. There's also the respect level of, hey, you do have a route here that, with the automatic qualifiers being positioned the way that they were a week ago, was severely limited to basically a team a year, maybe two. And under this, in Paul's example, if you have a really good year, well, then maybe you get three teams in there based on how it goes. And it's not automatically going to be the fifth best team in the Big Ten or the SEC every single year. But the way that they were setting it up with, you know, initially...
The money and the spots.
The money and the spots. It's like, okay, so you get way less money and you get a spot and maybe nothing more. And if you get that second one, it's going to be like a difficult thing to even get that second one. Or I guess if you were to give them two automatic qualifiers in another scenario as compared to four, like, still you're getting half and you're getting way less money. It's, look, there again, there's no winner or loser, I think, just based on the information we have available now. But if the presidents and those in charge feel like this was the best resolution to have everybody continue to be involved for the next few years, then you have to trust them on that, because it's their job to look out for the conference. Not that commissioners, presidents always make the right decisions. Look at the Pac-12. But I think that I'll give the benefit of the doubt to your marketing company and Mac Rhodes and those folks that this is the best route for the Big 12, for example.
Yeah, we don't know exactly what also is either this or this or this or that. Again, the revenue, it did not move a decimal. It did not move a percentage of what they're going to get. Now, we still want to look at what the actual true format will be and how that is broken down. But right now, there's the 5-9 formula. Five of the top, the five conference champions and then also the nine teams that get in based on how they earn it.
Yeah, I mean, the format's not even settled. So, like we were talking about earlier, they're talking about the four and nine, or what was it called?
5 and 9.
The 5 and 9. I mean, that's, we weren't talking about that last week. Now we're talking about it. So, yeah, we don't even know what that looks like. It could be another option that we're not even thinking of right now, although I think they've pretty clearly laid most of them out there. But when you talk about, like, not one more cent, what do you mean? Like,
well, if 58, 32, and 10, right? That's what it is going to be. It's not 57, 33, and 10. So nothing seems to change there at all when it comes to the money based on the $1.3 billion and how it's split up.
Yeah, but the playoffs are about to make more, and so I think that'll be for future consideration. I mean, down the line, there's that looking clause so that if a conference fades out, like the ACC crumbles, well, then the Big 12 can have a different say, or the SEC or the Big 10 or whoever exists at that point in time. I get it. Like, the money thing is still a concern. It's not a concern, but you're not making less money. You are making more money. It's not as much as the teams that were already making more money than you to begin with. Now they're making much more money than you are. And, yeah, I still think that's a concern. And I'll go back to the end of Ross's article, and we followed up on this earlier as well. If we do move, which it looks like we probably will, to a structure where there is employment or whatever that ends up looking like, and you are forced to pay the players through the university, then that's a significant advantage. But are we pretending like they didn't already have that advantage to begin with? But yes, that'll be a significant advantage that you can much more easily pay your players than and give them benefits than a school that's not making the same type of money. And so I guess we'll cross that bridge when we get there. I mean, if guys want to take a bunch of money to be a guy right in the bench in the SEC versus playing and competing at a ACC school, then that'll be the life choice that those players have to make. But the transfer portal is still going to be open. Like, it's not a guarantee that you just sign up to LSU and everybody that does is there for 4 years and you never leave and you just make – like, somebody's going to want to play and they're going to have their options are going to be going to the Big 12. Like, the players are not shrinking.
Yeah.
There's still thousands of players that need spots to play football. So if one league starts to make a lot more money and they want to go do something different in 3-4 years, then I think we talk about that when the time comes. But, you know, football as a whole and the teams and the fear of, like, not having programs, I think this is a day today where you don't have to worry about that for at least a little while. And to me, I'm going to take that as a positive because it's so easy to take every little piece of news as a negative.
I would have thought, again, we got to see how the format actually is set up. If, in fact, it is just the 5 and 9 and that's it, and nobody's guaranteed anything unless you earn it outside of the conference champions, then there was a little bit of give that the Big 12 and the ACC gets in return. But as far as the money breakdown, and the Big 10 and the SEC have all the dogs, we know that, and the attendance and the TV revenue. But I would have thought that there, and we don't know, at least something with the format, although I'm not so sure that's the case.
Well, that could be the actually having to earn your way through the field, as opposed to, hey, you joined this conference in 1810, you automatically, you know, get this no matter what. I think that the merit-based part of that, again, that'll depend on the format and what that looks like. And look, if it's a, for lack of a better term, well, I don't know, we might run this on TV. So if it's a bad deal, then let's pan the deal. We don't have to be loyal to Brett Yormark or to Jim Phillips or,
if the deal sucks,
we'll say it sucks. But based on what we know, which is, again, very limited information, is this not better than what you hoped for like 2 weeks ago when this was all being talked about and you were talking about squeezing people out?
No, I don't think it's better. It's not worse.
I'm not sure
it's better because I still want to know how that 14 team, if there's still any kind of kickers in there that we don't know about, that another conference is going to get more than just the conference champion who qualifies.
Here's the thing, is they had to settle on the money before going to the next phase. So we can't know everything right now.
There we go. It's got it.
We can't know everything.
You can't walk through the front door without turning the key.
So now let's cross. We built a bridge, guys. We built a bridge, and we can. Everybody's agreed to have this playoff for the next few years, and now we've crossed that bridge, and let's start building the bridge of what that actually looks like and the format and the distribution and all of that. But, yeah, I mean, I don't think that you're running around in the streets setting off fireworks if you're a Big 12 or an ACC fan by any means. But I don't know. I just think about it more in the extreme ways of there's this threat that people have almost, like, I've seen held against other fans who are just fans of college football that want to know they're going to be fans of college football moving forward, and this big bad boogeyman of your programs are going to shutter and you're not going to be involved whatsoever. This says otherwise. And you know what? The competitive disadvantage might be greater than it ever is before, but the fears of no access, at least, are not going to be there for a little while longer.
Or trying to form a different division outside of the, as you copyrighted, Super 2. When we come back, Evan Miyakawa, his latest, how he's run his stats, data, analytics, and more. And this is 365 Sports.
Riverbend Liquor and Wine, Lakeshore Drive at North 19th Street, and now in downtown Waco on Franklin. Oh, spring has nearly sprung. I know I was told by my wife that it has not officially sprung, but I'm wearing shorts today. And look, I mean, this is a nice little springtime color I've got on. Smokey's back into polos. I mean, this is springtime in Texas. We don't get a very long winter, although we'll probably have one really weird cold weekend here in the next 3 weeks that makes no sense at all. Yeah, right around Easter. It'll get cold for no reason, and then it'll just be 90 degrees. But that means springtime brews are out there in the craft beers. And I had one from Riverbend Liquor and Wine the other day I'd never heard of and tried it. Just grabbed one can of it. And now I got to go back and get more. There are so many different varieties that they roll through all the time. And with the seasons changing, that means a new roster of springtime beers. So go by Riverbend Liquor and Wine, Lakeshore Drive, North 19th Street, or in downtown Waco and find out. Cars priced right.
One size fits all. That may be all right for an adjustable belt or cheap sunglasses. But when it comes to your financial needs, no one wants a one size fits all strategy. Cam Heathcott, your Edward Jones financial advisor, knows that his most important goals are yours. That's why we take the time to understand your needs, knowing you. That's how Edward Jones makes sense of investing. Cam Heathcott in Conroe at 936-756-7717. Edward Jones, member SIPC.
Clinic Men's Healthcare in Woodway is now proud to offer you men an exceptional weight management body sculpting product called Semaglutide, also known as Ozempic or Wegovy. Semaglutide is an FDA-approved weight management medication. Once-a-week injections of this powerful medication offers an average body fat weight loss of 20% within the first year of treatment. In addition to body sculpting, Semaglutide also normalizes blood sugars and has the clinical research proof of reducing blood pressure, cholesterol, stroke, and heart attack risk. If you're like most men and you have stubborn fat that will just not respond to typical diets and exercise, then help is finally here. Semaglutide, affordable, highly effective. Google search Petty Clinic Waco and reach out to the Petty Clinic team today for a free consultation with Dr. Petty to see if Semaglutide is right for you. Go to PettyClinicLowT.com.
Pizza, burgers, and Bears football. There's no place around Waco that serves them all other than Bubba's 33. Come show your green and gold and enjoy some of Waco's best food and beverages while watching your favorite team, the Bears. When real Bears fans get hungry, Bubba's 33 is the number one spot for ice-cold drinks, hand-stretched, stone-baked pizzas, and bacon-infused burgers. Join us for indoor or patio dining. Bubba's 33, Waco's restaurant and proud supporter of Baylor Bears football. Sick 'em, Bears.
This is 365 Sports, powered by Sikkim365.com.
The 5 o'clock hour is brought to you by Edward Jones and financial advisor Cam Heathcott. Edward Jones, making sense of investing.
Now here's David Smoak, Paul Catalina, and Craig Smoak.
Analytics, data, numbers, evidence, etc. Evan Miyakawa, 365 Sports, joins us. And Evan can put all these numbers, crunch them into a whatever, and it spits out what might happen. It's amazing to me. Evan, thanks for your time with Paul, Craig, And Smokey, it's amazing to me. You have data, evidence, facts, whatever, and then you spit out who might in the latest algorithm, if that's the right word, may win it, and everybody goes, well, wait a minute, that can't be true. How much fun do you have doing what you're doing right now?
Yeah, so what you're referring to is bracket simulations that I have on my website, which basically takes the latest information on where teams are likely to be on Selection Sunday. Obviously, a lot is going to change in the next several days, but kind of places them, you know, roughly where they might be expected to be in the bracket, and then using data on how good each team is, simulates possible outcomes that the tournament could have. So this isn't necessarily predicting how a tournament is going to go. It's more saying this is just as likely an outcome as something else. And so, you know, a lot of times I like to, you can simulate these on my website. I put some of them on Twitter, and they often look pretty crazy. But then when you look at previous tournaments and how they've actually gone, last year, you know, we had Florida Atlantic and San Diego State and Miami in a Final Four. So a lot of these simulations kind of look tame in comparison.
Hey, I just ran one and Alabama's winning it all. So if you're a Tide fan,
roll Tide.
Roll internet on that.
And they'll average 103 points a game in the tournament. Yeah,
absolutely. But, Evan, have you seen anything yet that's a potential shakeup in the brackets that has happened so far in conference tournaments?
I think something that in particular to the Big 12 that I'm fascinated by is Kansas and their injury situation. I mean, we always regard Kansas as being, coached by arguably the best coach in the game, and their success, their identity is in March tournament success. And so Bill Self has made a decision to rest Kevin McCullough and Hunter Dickinson, who are dealing with injuries, just not play them in the Big 12 tournament. And so that it can be healthy next week. And what that has meant is that not only, you know, they're playing tonight against Cincinnati, not only are they going to be predicted to lose that game by a couple points because of those injuries, but that also potentially it just makes a lot of things unclear in terms of next week. If they lose this game tonight, will that impact their seed? But hopefully leading to a more healthy roster for them. So I'm just fascinated by this situation and curious to see how it goes for them.
Evan, is Oklahoma in?
That is a good question. If I'm just kind of pulling up the latest stuff here, I think they're pretty comfortably in right now. Consensus is kind of around a 9 seed. Obviously, losing a game in the tournament could hurt them against TCU, but the Big 12 is so strong that I don't necessarily think that, you know, them losing in the Big 12 tournament is going to knock them out of the tournament picture. So I think they're comfortably in at this point.
Evan Miyakawa with us. Again, it's EvanMiya.com. It's great just to go in as Paul just did and ran himself a simulator.
Yeah, absolutely. It did take seconds, mere seconds, to find out countless data points on his website. Evan, for Baylor and what they've got going, if they get to the championship game, do they move up a line or do they have to win it?
I think if they make it to the championship game, they would be in serious consideration to move from the 3 line to the 2 line, based on how some things play. They're going to be playing the winner of Kansas-Cincinnati tonight, and then potentially you've got Iowa State in the semifinal. That would be a huge win if they were able to get that. Iowa State right now is probably considered to be the last 2 seed. And so if Baylor were to beat Iowa State, I think that would probably carry some weight for the selection committee to potentially have Baylor jump Iowa State. So obviously a lot of it depends on the other teams kind of around them and how they perform the next several days. But I think even if Baylor were to lose to Houston in the title game, for example, I think that still might be enough to get them to a 2 seed line.
Evan, take us into the relative rating on those Houston Cougars, fresh off the Big 12 regular season title. We'll see what damage they do in the tourney, but I know you had a post on them a couple days back. What did the formulas and your metrics say about Houston and their relative rating?
So basically, kind of the summary on Houston is that they are better than any other team in the country, arguably, at beating up on teams that they should be favored against. So, you know, against bottom half Big 12 teams and the like, I don't think you could trust another team in the country to handle business. But the statistical models do point to the fact that they are slightly weaker against elite teams. Now, that still means that they are one of the teams with the most likely chance of winning the national title. But compared to some other websites that you'll see out there that rate teams, I do have the number one, and that is because I would project them right now to lose slightly to teams like UConn and Purdue. So I have them number three. Now, I still think that means they are one of the strongest teams in the country. They're arguably the most likely team to get to the Sweet 16 or Elite Eight potentially, just because of how good they are at not losing games that they should win. But when you're talking about the latter half of the tournament, when you're getting up against top four seeds, top three seeds, you know, there's still a little bit to be desired there. And the data suggests that that could be a weak point for them. So we'll see how they go. But I'm still definitely very I still would like to trust Houston in this tournament. Obviously, Kelvin Sampson's a great coach. He's taken them to the Final Four in recent memory before. This definitely doesn't mean doom for them in any means, but you know, still work to be done in proving themselves against the cream of the crop.
Evan, is there a chance to see which of the eight or nine teams in the Big 12 make it are the most erratic, that your algorithm could say there may be even a Sweet 16 or Elite Eight? But a lot of them also say they could be down and done by the end of the first weekend. For example, BYU looks, they're playing really well. They're not going to be way up, but they're really playing well. Even the teams that have been up and down, whether it's Tech or Baylor, et cetera, is there somebody that is more erratic looking than others?
So one team I would point, and you mentioned them before, is Oklahoma. And the reason I point them out is that when you look at their team summary on my website, they are one of the most volatile teams from game to game. What that means is they're in the top 15 teams in the country or so at having kind of inconsistent game performances from game to game. So that means you could get a really strong Oklahoma one night and a really weak Oklahoma the next. And what that means is, you know, they're going to be kind of hovering around that, you know, nine line right now. So if they were to win their first game, that means that they potentially have a better chance of beating a one seed in their second game than other eight or nine seeds would, because they're just kind of more volatile from game to game. So that could work in their favor in this instance, where they could be more likely to have a great performance against another good team. But that also does mean that they could put up a stinker in their first game. So, you know, really anything could happen with them.
Evan Miyakawa with us again. Go to Evan, M-I-Y-A, and he will, you can just dial it up, and amazing sometimes what can change in just one click of the button compared to the next simulator.
All right, Evan, four number one seeds right now.
We lose him?
Evan, oh, sorry. I wasn't sure if you had a question to follow that up. Are you just asking me who's on the one
who
line?
Who are they right now? Yeah.
Okay, so Purdue, UConn, and Houston are comfortably on the one line, and really it's down to, I would argue at this point, just Tennessee and North Carolina realistically to get that final one seed spot. Arizona was in contention, but they lost to USC this weekend. Marquette could be in the conversation, but Tyler Kolek is not healthy right now, so that doesn't bode well for their Big East tournament chances. I guess theoretically, if Iowa State were to win the Big 12 tournament and beat, you know, Baylor and Houston in route, I guess you could have a case if Tennessee or North Carolina don't perform well in their tournaments. But I really think it comes down to Tennessee and North Carolina, and right now I would give the edge to Tennessee to be on the one line as things stand right now.
Thank you, Evan. You are growing into people love you and hate you based on just a simulator. I love it. It's great. And the fact that you're out there and so many people know about what you do, that's wonderful. We were there on the ground floor. Don't ever forget us.
Absolutely not.
That's Evan Miyakawa. EvanMiya.com. I'm on the, and it's M-I-Y-A. I'm on the site right now. Kyle Visser, I think, just asked about it. And there you go. EvanMiya.com. When we come back, Paul Catalina and the top five.
On April 8th, between 11 and 3 at Waco Regional Tennis and Fitness on Lakeshore Drive in Waco, Far Out Solar Eclipse Day. Central Texas is one of the places where you have an unobstructed view of the solar eclipse. April the 8th, 11 to 3, Waco Regional Tennis and Fitness. Members and guests enjoy special open play for tennis and pickleball. $5 guest fee instead of what normally is $10 throughout the day, including enjoying group exercise classes, weight room, which is spectacular, tennis and pickleball courts, and complimentary solar eclipse eyewear. Local true Jamaican food truck available 11 to 2, live band on the patio, outside on the concourse in the back with Jay Smith and the Wesson from 12 to 2. Take advantage of the unobstructed view from the stadium court
at Waco Regional Tennis and Fitness. Beer and wine available for sale. Family, friendly, and fun. The Far Out Solar Eclipse Day, April the 8th, 11 to 3. Specials for both members and guests at Waco Regional Tennis and Fitness on Lakeshore Drive in Waco.
Rev up your excitement. Celebrate the spirit of adventure during the Jeep Celebration event. Join us at Alan Samuels in Waco as we roll out incredible deals on rugged and reliable Jeep vehicles you love. Seize the moment and drive home in the new Jeep of your dreams. With special financing options and exclusive offers, there has never been a better time to explore the world of Jeep. Hurry in. The savings won't last long. Visit AlanSamuelsDCJ.com and see them firsthand only at Alan Samuels in Waco. Let your adventure begin.
Come by. Let's be friends.
At Ideal MRI, we feel blessed to be a part of the Waco community. We're a small family business right here in Central Texas, and our goal is to bring down the cost of healthcare while maintaining high quality. At times like this, the cost of healthcare has never been more important, and unfortunately, significant illnesses and injuries still occur. That's why Ideal MRI is open and here to serve you through the difficult time. We offer premium MRIs just like a hospital with state-of-the-art technology and specialists, but you'll pay less. Sometimes thousands of dollars less, whether you're using insurance or not. At Ideal MRI, we accept most insurance and there are no hidden costs, even offering financing if that's needed. Everything included in the price, and you'll not get something as a surprise in the mail later on. If you need an MRI, ask your doctor about Ideal MRI. They'll know. You can schedule an appointment safely from home online in minutes at IdealMRI.com or give us a call, 833-IDEAL-MRI, IdealMRI.com.
TFNB, your bank for life, is the official local bank of Baylor Athletics. Find out why more Central Texans are making TFNB their bank for life. Sign up for our Edge checking and savings accounts to earn interest or cash back. With 5 convenient locations and an award-winning mobile app, banking has never been easier. TFNB, your bank for life. Member FDIC.
Want to know why Stonewood Dental is so successful? Listen to what happy customers have to say.
Pleasant. It's different than any other dentist's office. I really feel like they care. And it's not that you're here for 2 hours waiting on someone to take care of you. It's quick and easy. And, you know, I bring my kids, and my kids love being here too. They really love the treasure box. Staff is really nice and accommodating, real friendly. You feel more like home. It's not sterile looking. Everybody has their own personalized rooms with decorations and decor, and they'll even have a blanket for you when it's cold. I've recommended people to actually come here, and they are patients now. I really love it here. It feels like family.
Learn more, stonewood-dental.com.
Time for Paul Catalina's Top 5, brought to you by Texas Beef House. Where's the best beef in Texas? Your house when you order from Texas Beef House. Unleash the flavor of Texas-raised Wagyu. From our pasture to your plate, TexasBeefHouse.com.
Top 5 Louisville candidates. I'll give everybody a guess as who's not on this list. And
Bill Self.
He is absolutely not. You're right. He's not on the list.
Hurley.
Not on this list. But I think maybe you, if you ask some Louisville fans, they're like, why can't we call Dan Hurley?
Yeah.
UConn's only won 5 national championships.
Reach for the stars, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Number 5, Scott Davenport at Bellarmine. They're always in the tournament. He's really good. Now, this would be a reach outside into the mid-majors, obviously, and a small mid-major at that. But, you know, maybe going outside the norm and not hiring an alum or going for a big name that eventually gets you wrapped up in scandal, maybe that's the way to go here. And I've got a couple of smaller names on this list before we get to 3 bigger ones. But I think, you know, I don't know a ton about him, but I do know that Bellarmine pretty much in the tournament all the time. So, you know, they're fighting their way through. If he can do that at Bellarmine, he sure as hell can do it at Louisville. So, number four, one of the best stories of the year is Indiana State. Josh Schertz has done a great job there year in and year out. This is another one from the mid-majors. Look, he can find, diamond in the rough recruits in this crazy era. And moving that to Louisville to take over for a team that's won, 12 games in 2 years, Smokey, or 15 games, whatever it is, that Kenny Payne won.
It was 12 and 52
over the last 2 years. Josh Schertz could certainly improve on that. If you've watched Indiana State play this year, they're fun to watch. They're a good watch, and they play a style of basketball that's really fun. And Louisville fans know their game, and so does Josh Schertz. So this one, to me, would be a very interesting and a nice move up, too. And also not just going, who's a big guy at a big place? Let's go get him.
Mm-hmm. Yep, Indiana State, man, anytime, doesn't matter, 20 years from now, I hope I'm around. I don't know if I will be, but I'll always think of Larry Bird.
Yeah.
The 1979 team that ran the table until they ran into Magic in Michigan State in the championship game.
Number three, Smokey, a guy that you know well, yes. Brad Underwood, Illinois. Now, look, Illinois is a really good spot. He's done a really good job at Illinois, but he's also a guy that has never been afraid to move, and if Louisville makes him a competitive offer – I would see
Man,
that
Illinois,
that would be
a- they are very committed when it comes to basketball, and I know Louisville thinks they are and probably are. They just haven't had a really, really good run. Stephen F. Austin to Oklahoma State was there for a cup of coffee straight to Illinois. So,
yeah, so I mean, we'll see. I mean, but I do think that this one makes a little bit of sense for them, especially since he's had big success in a big conference. Not big success, but pretty damn good success at Illinois in a big conference, and that's what they want. Although not, maybe winning a national title. He has not done that, but one to consider. Number two, if you want some attitude, Eric Musselman from Arkansas. He's the SEC is about to get a lot deeper with the two new teams coming in. And maybe you do take a chance to jump into the ACC with an opportunity at Louisville starting at the bottom to build them up. Or do you use this as Arkansas to get more money? As they've had some success, obviously, under Eric Musselman. He's a firebrand, to say the least, and can be a bit of a, I'll just say it, a clown over there on the sidelines, but he's a very good basketball coach and he's a very good recruiter. And he's, he's a guy who's been considered, he's been in the NBA. He knows how to coach that kind of style of basketball. I think this one kind of fits Louisville a little bit to me.
Yeah. His emotions, he and Nate Oates, I don't know. I'm not trying to compare the two, but because they both are in the SEC. Musselman, he's sometimes, calm down a little bit.
Yeah.
And maybe that's what they need at Louisville. I don't know.
Yeah, I think that you would bring some
energy.
Not
been a good year for Arkansas this year, that's for sure.
No, absolutely not. But he's had some success in the past.
Yeah, just as a program, you talk about teams in danger of being the botter feeder, not as a program, as a university, as far as the big two sports. It seems like they're kind of floundering at the wrong moment while others are having success. And this would be a certain – a blow to take as well. I wonder in basketball how much the difference in the conferences and money and all the things that come with that, how much that will affect the basketball coaching ranks when it comes to head coaches. It's obvious if the guy takes from Oklahoma State, takes the Ohio State job, but is the Arkansas job going to be automatically better than the K-State job, just simply not based on history or anything, but just because of the league that they're in? That's something I wonder about moving forward.
I want to go back to Illinois and Louisville. Louisville, when I was growing up with Denny Crum and all the things they did, it was a great job. They haven't done much in a long time. I think Illinois might be the best job in the Big Ten with Michigan struggling, Ohio State. Purdue, of course, that Painter's done a great job, but I'm still not so sure. Indiana's not who they were or have been for a long time. That would take a monumental deal in front of Underwood, for him to leave Illinois.
And the reason I put him on there is he's just a guy who he's open to that, a possibility, more than, maybe somebody in Waco would be. Or Mick, keep talking about Mick Cronin at UCLA. He's got a $20 million buyout.
Yeah.
Let's be real here, Louisville. And this is the dude I would hire. I would hire Dusty May from FSU. Young guy, homeboy had FAU in the Final Four last year. FAU. Okay? He can coach. He's got good enthusiasm. He's young. He's vibrant. Let's go get Dusty May if I'm Louisville and shoot some life into the ACC, which was this year. And it doesn't help to have one of your best basketball brands be finishing last, but outside of Duke and Pitt, North Carolina, I'm leaving somebody else, but like it's kind of a dud of a year for the ACC. Miami was way down. You know, Leonard Hamilton needs to retire. You know, there's all these things going on. Clemson looked like they might be good, but it kind of, you know. And so Virginia's not what they were under Tony Bennett. They're still okay, but they're not any great shakes. So, yeah, you know, bring some new life.
Bring some, breath of fresh air. And I don't know what the situation is with them with recruiting-wise. Louisville, again, usually speaks for itself. But, man, they have been awful. And May, he might like it where he is because of the fact he could win the conference, get to the tournament, and make a deep run occasionally.
Yeah, but I think in talking to Tom Herman yesterday, we realized there's very much a split gap with where he is and where a program like Arkansas is. Yep. So that would be, again, that goes back to the money thing I just brought up of how much of an effect is there from a Big 12 ACC level if, you know, there's this big separation versus an SEC or a Big Ten type of a job. But, yeah, I mean, FAU, I mean, they're further down that chain. In basketball, maybe it's more unique, and that doesn't matter as much, but that's going back to the question that I had of, like, how much does that make a difference now in how even basketball jobs are perceived? But, yeah, he's done a great job, obviously, and would be a name you kick the tires on for sure.
All right.
That's it.
There you go. There's the five right in the middle. A former Lumberjack coach, I like that, with Brad Underwood, who, again, spent time for a cup of coffee at Oklahoma State. Garrett Ross, thank you very much. I just got a text from our good friend Taylor Bryan, who's at North Texas, was at Baylor. What in the hell's going on with your Huskers? Yeah, that's a great question. It was a story from earlier today with Trev Alberts, now official, the AD at A&M.
You tell Taylor Bryan to apply for that job. He's a mover and a shaker, that
no,
TV.
He's...
Look, if there's somebody I know who could handle it, like day one,
he would get them in shape. I don't know if we ever asked what their alternate is now for them.
I mean, it's a nice move for A&M. I think we need to like tap the brakes a little bit on how great Trev Alberts is, though.
Yeah. No, he's not great about it.
Are acting like he's. I don't think it's right to act as though this is like getting the five-star quarterback per se, but it is an interesting move because of where Nebraska certainly sees themselves. And where A&M sees themselves and how Nebraska fans view A&M, I don't think they view that as a job that's exceptionally better than theirs, especially for a guy who went to school at Nebraska to go and take that, especially then in the middle of having just recently made a big move like the hire of Matt Rhule. So that is something that we're going to have to wait to hear from Trev Alberts on and get some clarity on why that went down. And I know Nebraska fans are probably eager to learn that. But, yeah, that's something to – continue to watch, I guess, the next couple days. And then the fallout from this playoff. I mean, we got the news at the start of the show, and I think everybody's still unpacking the news. And based on what response that you got back in reaching out, how do you feel about just the general news today?
I thought that there would be a little bit more give, that the ACC and the Big 12 would maybe get a couple of more nuggets, and I don't even know what that means. Maybe it's just a perk or two. But it seemed like pretty much it's exactly what was on the table in the first place.
So why?
Still very lucrative.
Yeah.
Still a lot of money, three times more than any of them are making right now. I am not surprised if the ACC gets an extra percentage or two because they still have some alphas. They got the logos in Clemson and Florida State, Miami, North Carolina. So that's not a surprise.
And if that falls apart, they have the look in 4 years, and that changes.
I want to know what the format. And now that they have the money set, which is what Ross and everyone else has been reporting, including even those in the college football leadership area, what will the format look like? Is it the 5+9, or is there a couple of intricacies inside there that may still be you take this or not?
Yeah, and that's something that Paul and I can get more into tomorrow on this set up and what that could look like, and obviously what the reactions are. And I would just pose this question to anybody who's asking of like, why didn't the Big 12 or the ACC ask for more? Man, they're getting screwed. I'm seeing a lot of like they signed their own death certificate. And you know what? That very well may be true. My whole point is that they've at least secured the next few years, which is more than you could have said before this agreement was made. And there are a lot of details to come. But I pose this question to you guys, and I pose this to the audience who says they should have held out for more money, or they should have this, or they should have that. And maybe they should have. But tell me how they were going to go about doing that and what the solution to that was. What were they going to do? Were they going to just hold out and argue until they got their way, knowing full well that you're already kind of
no,
like,
you know
what were you going
what did
to
Washington
do differently?
State, what did Kirk Schultz and Washington State and Oregon State eventually have to do? It's just,
yeah,
this is what
I mean,
it is. This
look,
is reality.
It's not fun to say, you know, get the bend the knee gif in front of you when it comes to the conference that your team plays in. But I ask you then, if you don't like it, what is the alternative? And maybe the alternative in 4 years when there's that look in and the ACC exists or it doesn't or whatever is the big split because the money is just so ridiculous. But at least we know the playoff format, which was a big hurdle, and now we can start moving on to we know the playoff has been agreed upon, and now we can move forward to the structure. And then, yes, is this the death of college football? Maybe, but I don't take it as, like, grave news today. And I ask you again, what would they do differently? What were they going to argue and fight for that was going to make the Big Ten and the SEC go, you know what, guys, you're right. We're grabbing too much money. You guys have this. And like I said earlier, that money part of it, at some point, does some of it become almost negligible? If we do go to this new world and there are rosters and basically South Carolina wants to pretend to be like the Carolina Panthers or something, then that will be a much different world and not one that we're talking about. And college football is still going to exist at multiple levels. So let's a lot still of mysteries to figure out here, but at least one step forward was made today, and now we can start talking about the next few steps forward.
Yeah, the details come out. We'll figure that out along the way. But the bottom line is you're still a part of the four conferences that are getting the largest chunk with the SEC, Big Ten, the ACC, and also the Big 12. More news maybe even by tomorrow. I'm going to be out the next couple of days, headed down to see my brothers in Florida. By the way, Craig, happy birthday before I say goodbye, which is on Friday.
Yep.
The big...
Yep, the big one, big 4-0.
The big 4-0. Yep. Paul, you were there 10 years ago.
Welcome. No, 4 years ago. 4 years ago. I'm turning 44 in April.
44, Henry Aaron, but, Willie McCovey.
Yeah, but welcome aboard, Craig.
Yeah. You know, I was going to negotiate and argue that I was going to be 35 for forever, but guess what?
Yeah.
Can't do anything about it. Yeah.
Garrett Ross, thank you very much. Jack McKenzie, Emery Winters working on 365 Sports tonight on the CW. And also, if you haven't, before you say goodnight, hit the like button. If you haven't, also subscribe, and we would appreciate that. This is 365 Sports. I'm David Smoak. Have a great night.